Christ Jesus, worthy is the Lamb. Christ the King, the King above all kings. Oh, Jesus Christ the King, the Lord of lords. Oh, Jesus Christ the King of kings. Oh, Jesus Christ the King, you're the Lord of lords. Oh, Jesus Christ the King.
Worthy is the Lamb.
Christ Jesus, worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb. Oh, Jesus Christ, the King, you're the King of kings. Jesus Christ, the Lord.
Christ the King. You're the King of Kings, Jesus Christ the Lord. You're the Lord of Lords, oh Jesus Christ the King. You're the King of Kings, Jesus Christ the Lord. You're the Lord of Lords, oh Jesus Christ the King. Jesus Christ the Lord, you're the Lord of Lords. Oh, Jesus Christ the King, you're the King of Kings. Jesus Christ the Lord, you're the Lord of Lords.
Almighty God.
Almighty God.
the Lord Most High.
O Lord Most High,
we bow before you.
Great I am. Everlasting God. All powerful.
Bow before you.
Sovereign King.
Sovereign King. Almighty God.
The Lord Most High.
The Lord Most High.
Bow before you.
Great I am, the great I am. All powerful, everlasting God, everlasting God,
we bow before you.
Sovereign King,
Sovereign King,
Almighty God,
Almighty God,
the Lord Most High,
the Lord Most High,
we bow before you.
The great I am,
the great I am.
Everlasting God,
everlasting God, all powerful,
bow before you.
To you, Lord, belongs all power,
to you belongs all power,
to you belongs.
Belongs all authority
to you. Belongs all things,
belongs all things.
We bow before you.
To you belongs all power.
To you belongs all power.
To you belongs all authority.
To you belongs all authority.
Belongs all things, and we bow before you.
Sovereign King, Almighty God,
the Lord
Most
High, we bow. Everlasting God,
all
great I am, everlasting. All power, we bow before you. Thank you.
is the context in which the church begins to prophesy one by one. Those who have taken a hold of this wonderful gifting of the Holy Ghost flow and operate in the things of the Spirit. And as you hunger for God, as you cry out to Him in a sincere heart, Father, we'll do these things in you. It won't take years. Just yieldedness to Him. Amen. He'll take the fear away. He'll take the condemnation away. And He'll fill you with a confidence and a boldness and assurance in the Holy Ghost. You'll begin to have lots of fun in church. Holy Spirit, to glorify the name of Jesus, that each person can begin to function and operate in the glory of heaven and the authority and the power, Father, which you have freely given to everybody who will receive. Father, we thank you that your church will be your church, filled with your glory, filled with your power, filled with your splendor, as each person begins to yield themselves over to you, Holy Spirit, to function in all that Father has provided for us through Christ Jesus. Lord Jesus, we praise you and thank you for your blood. We thank you for your everlasting love, for your grace, for your mercy, for your tender affections towards us. Hallelujah. We praise you, mighty God. Woo-hoo! Woo-hoo! Hallelujah. Thank you, Father, for the floods of heaven, floods of glory, floods of your anointing, the floods of your Spirit, the working of your mighty power, O God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Sovereign King, Almighty God, we bow before you. Hallelujah. Great I am, the everlasting God, all powerful. Lord, we worship you. Thank you.
God, you are my God, you're all I want, all I desire. Oh God, you are my God, you're all I want, all I desire. Oh God, you are my God, you're all I want, all I desire. So Jesus, take me, mold and make me, I yield my life to you. Lord Jesus, take me, mold and make me, I yield my life to you.
Oh God,
oh God, you are my God, you're all I want, all I desire. Oh God, you are my God, you're all I want, all I desire.
Jesus, take me,
oh Jesus. Jesus, take me, mold and make me, I yield my life to you. Oh God, you are my God, you are all I want, all I desire. Oh God, you are my God. You are my God, you're all I want, all I desire. Oh God, you are my God, you're all I want, all I desire. Oh God, you are my God, all I want, all I my God, you're all I want, all I desire. Oh God, you are my God, you're all I want, all I desire.
Jesus, take me, hold and make me, I yield my life to you, Jesus. Jesus, take me, mold and make me, I yield my life to you. Oh God, you are my God,
rejoice in you, Lord. Oh, always, oh, I will rejoice in the Lord. Oh, always, oh, I will rejoice in the Lord. Oh, always, oh, I will rejoice in the Lord. Oh, always, oh, I will rejoice in the Lord.
God, Blessed are those who know their God. Blessed is the name of the Most High God. Blessed are those who know their God. Hallelujah! 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 Lord, we praise you. Lord, I praise your holy name. Lord, I praise you, O God, mighty God, and I worship you, Lord, Most High. Woo-hoo! And I worship you, Lord. And I praise your name. And I lift my hands, O God. Hallelujah. In worship unto you, just like the fire on the altar, O God of sacrifice. I worship you by the price of the blood of your own Son. And I worship you, Holy God, by the Spirit that you gave. And I worship you, Lord. We worship you, Most High, we worship you, O God, by the Spirit and with the understanding also. And we worship you in tongues of fire, O God, and we worship you with the language that we know. We worship you, O God. We will not withhold from you that which you gave, O God. We thank you, Father, for this glorious thing. Call this work of grace in this place, oh Lord, your signs, your wonders, and your miracles, your signs and your wonders, oh God, you're working, and the working of your mighty power, and your signs and wonders, oh God. Father, the issuing forth the praise, oh, your signs and wonders, oh God, your Spirit flowing like rivers of living water. Oh God, we praise you. We praise your holy name. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for the work of grace. Hallelujah. Jesus, Jesus.
People keep wondering how we can love on God more and what we can do to love on him more. There's nothing we can do. All we can do is worship him. We can't, there's no deeds, nothing. All we can do is worship him more. That's how we can show his love, our love for him. Because he loves us so much. We have with an everlasting love. Yeah, he loves us so much.
Yes, he does.
There's nothing that we can do. Just worship him. Woo-hoo. There's nothing you can do but worship.
Hallelujah. Yeah. Woo-hoo. We give you praise, Almighty God. We give you praise and we worship you. We worship you.
Thank you, Jesus.
You know, Father, it's just so earnest. Welcome, everybody. Glad you're here. But listen, I just want you to understand. Father, just so earnest for us to have an intimacy, a relationship with him on the level where we're receiving what he's giving. So many people have got stuck in religion and they have a relationship with the Lord on trying to beg him and somehow talk him into liking them. It's time that you change. There's not a more important thing to understand than the fact that Father did something that goes beyond anything that a human being can describe. When we talk about him giving his only begotten Son so that you and I could have everything that was standing in the way of this kind of relationship removed. Father doesn't want a relationship in which he's very happy with us and we're very unhappy with him. Condemnation is being very unhappy with God. And a lot of it is because people make their relationship with Father about themselves and they worship God based upon how they feel about themselves. And it's really the culture that you were born in. It's the lies that were imposed upon you from a very small child. And the Spirit of the Lord has come to erase all that and change all of that. People believe that they are allowed to get and have what they deserve. And with God, that has nothing to do with anything. And the first person that even begins to think that somehow they're getting from God something that they deserve, they've never encountered His holiness. They've never encountered His greatness. He's the Almighty God. He is the omnipotent one. In the beginning, in Genesis, it says God describes God as Almighty. In the end, in Revelation, at the very end, it describes God as omnipotent. He's all-powerful. He is the one who is the sovereign, absolute authority of all things. He's the one who defines all of the rules, and all of his rules are based upon His love. There's nothing that describes Him more than that. And in this, He has an unlimited amount of everything. And in the midst of that, you listen to me now. Listen to me. In the midst of that, you and I are everything unlike Him. We are everything because of sin that He rejects and recoils from, as it were. He says, no, I'm not having anything to do with you. No. Because He's a holy, holy, holy God. He belongs in a realm called holiness. Father, in His love and His mercy, worked a work of salvation for us to where that we could now be able to come to Him by the blood of Jesus. And some people, I don't know what they think. Was that once or something, or at communion time? Because see, when you begin to grab a hold of these things, this is where praise comes from in worship. It doesn't come from because somebody wrote a song. These inspirations don't just come. God gonna flood our lives and our souls with unlimited inspiration, rivers of inspiration. But it's already inspiration enough just to look at what God has done. I mean, if you begin to understand who He is, there's nobody who's deserving to get anywhere near Him. The reality of it is, as the psalmist said, all of His paths are mercy. Mercy is where you get something and you do not deserve it at all. You don't deserve it at all. You don't deserve it at all. And as long as you're going to have a relationship on deserving, you're never going to flow in the Holy Ghost. Because the most important connection that God wants us to make through the blood of Jesus Christ is the connection with the Holy Ghost, the Holy Spirit. And that connection is a joy divine, a love that goes beyond all comprehension of men. It is that place where we are allowed by God to begin to receive of His unlimited power, His unlimited authority, His unlimited goodness. And one day that will create within you just the sound of that. Somebody saying that will create within you a shout. It will create, because see, right now what it does is it creates within people a sense of condemnation. Because it's still all self-evaluation. And so they're quiet, they're hushed. There's no inspiration of greatness and release and freedom. But by God's help and grace, we're going to do everything we can do to help you. I think sometimes that people who understand, who basically lean towards grace and lean towards mercy, have more of an opportunity to hook up with God than those who lean towards understanding that, yeah, Father wants to teach us how to walk perfectly before Him. I think that, you know, when we start expounding on the fact that He's made us in righteousness and true holiness, that He's recreated us, that He's given us a new heart and a new spirit, and we start describing all that God has given to us of Himself to walk with Him, to be like Him, then people get stuck in what they have been fashioned in a Western society, and then they really become all about performance-based, and out of that performance-based thing, they could become performance relationship with God. And it just messes the whole thing up. There's no way you can flow in the anointing. Condemnation will never, shame. Doing and interacting with God based upon what you think you deserve, you never can connect with Him. You're not even allowed in, actually. You're not even allowed in, actually. You're not even allowed in. So we're going to have to understand, we got to find a people who are willing to start letting God teach them the full gospel. Amen. Not half gospel. Amen. The full gospel. Amen. Not just some dimension of what man can do in service to the Lord, but what men can do as they yield themselves to the Holy Ghost, because that's the only kind of service that Father wants, really wants. Not just for people who understand holiness and righteousness and purity, but people who understand God's love and mercy and grace, that everything about Him, I mean, it is a love that is, you know, a mother may forget her child. Think about this. A mother who has a child who's born and lives and because there's that much more attachment as the baby is here and the baby grows. A mother may forget her child, but Father will not forget you. And Father's going to help you with a little bit more than just a hand clap. And praise God, hand clap is worship, but it's worship without anything in your mouth. And I tell you, I know what the problem is. It's called fear. It's called shame. It's called condemnation. And the enemy has fought so hard against the full gospel, the full message of salvation being preached and being received. And, you know, I often looked at situations where people have, you know, just almost as it were, just removed just the concept of even talking about holiness and sanctification and purity and righteousness out of the equation and just talk about mercy and grace, because you have a whole lot more, you have a whole lot more flow and a whole lot more freedom. And in that, you're going to have some people that are going to take it right and recognize what God is going to do through that in terms of establishing all of His ways in us, and then you're going to have segments of people who are going to do nothing with that, and they're going to continue on in their iniquity. But reality of it is, even in holiness movements, you've got people who still continue on in their iniquity. And so we wonder, you know, and this conversation has gone on over and over again behind closed doors among people who are theologians, people who are pastors, people who are desperate about seeing God's people move in the anointing. And the conclusion is, people can't handle a message beyond mercy and grace. I can. But must there only be just a few? I can't, because all of that which God has called me to do, I find only in His mercy and His grace. I find my holiness in Him, His holiness in me through His mercy and grace. I find that it stayed intact because of the blood of Jesus Christ. When I think of mercy, I just think of blood. I think of Jesus. When I think of grace, I think of Jesus. When I think of holiness, I think of Jesus. When I think of righteousness, I think of Jesus. When I think of, you know, He's perfecting everything that concerns me, I think of Jesus. I didn't think of Jesus. I'm just always thinking of Jesus. When I think about what He wants me to do, I think of Jesus. When I think about what I haven't done or haven't accomplished, I think of Jesus. And a lot of people get stuck there. And rather, because we'll try to provoke people and say, listen, what God has called you to do, what have you done? Look at what you've done. And the reality of it is we start trying to get people to examine themselves. Just because we know Satan is a deceiver and he make people believe that they're, you know, that they've done everything that God's called them to do and they act like it. And you know, and it squelches hunger. And we just want to get rid of that sense of people hunger, because God's going to do everything for you because you just want Him to. In other words, let me say it this way. God's going to do everything that He wants to do in your life that you desire Him to do because you are just so desperate for it. You just got to have it. I mean, just make it just like that. You just got to have it. You can't live without it. And let that be hunger and thirst. Because I think sometimes we don't understand what is hunger and thirst. What is hunger and thirst? We're like a person learning a language. What is hunger and thirst? ¿Cómo se dice en español? You know, what do you say? How do you say this in English? You know what I'm saying? You with me? I pray today that every single person in this place gets settled in. That God's not going to do anything ever for you on what you deserve, because the best you do is just, come on, give me a break. I know people pat you on the back, give you little gold stars and A's on your paper. Bless your darling heart. Get over it. and that you basically, you get more money if you do well, and you get less money if you don't do well, and that is so jaded humanity. You get the praises of men if you, you know, if you outrun everybody else, and if you come in last, you know, they're starting to get people trophies for this now. Sound like there's a success and failure. That's not what we're saying. It's just that reality of it is we've been made successful in Christ Jesus. And that with all, and then, and you know what? Everything that you see that is a failure in your life today that is coming short right now today, everything that you see, huh? Just wait till you get that right in God and He allows you to see a little bit more of Him, because you're going to see a whole lot more of things that you need to get right. And could you imagine if you're living always in this performance-based thing of whether you deserve it, you're going to be miserable for the rest of eternity. You're going to be miserable for the rest of eternity. Ooh, do you realize how holy God is? Do you have any clue how pure He is, how perfect He is, how wonderful He is? And He invited you and I in, not deserving anything. Hello. And there's something about His goodness and His mercy that's like new every morning. He doesn't fail. It's abundant in mercy. His faithfulness reaches under the clouds. I mean, if you want to look at how the priest you're supposed to minister, the Lord is good and His mercy endures forever. Let all of you say, and the Lord is good and His mercy endures forever. And let all the people say, and the Lord is good and His mercy endures forever. And let all the people say, and the Lord is good and His mercy endures forever. Some people ask me, they say, what do I need to get a breakthrough? A lot of times I'm like thinking, all you need to do is be thankful and smile. Just be thankful and be happy. Your biggest breakthrough is going to come from being thankful and be happy. But I haven't, you know, I can only be happy about my accomplishments. I'm really happy if I fast 6 days. I feel really good about myself. And if you think start breaking this down, you start, wait a minute. There's a lot of things that my day is based upon how I feel about myself rather than how God and His love and His grace and His mercy feels about me. Huh? A mother may forget her child, but Father's never going to forget about me. He's written me upon and engraved me upon the palms of His hands. Tattooed me. Tattooed. Whoa. You know, so that's why I have a hard time, you know, trying to anyway defend anything about somebody saying, well, look, God tattooed His name on His hand for me. Why can't I tattoo His name on my hand for Him? It's like, well, I can't really say anything about that. The other tattoos have got to go, though. What happens when we begin to start enjoying the mercy of God and understanding the mercy of God and recognizing that everything that He's ever done for us is all about mercy? And it's really the reality of mercy is that it's something that we get not because we deserve it, but we don't deserve it. I want you to sit down and I want you to run and read something to you. Hallelujah. I'm pressing in that my eyes aren't dim and that I don't need these glasses. And I can see pretty good where I'm at right now, but I see even better when it's like this, and it's a little odd. I saw a guy on the airplane doing this. I'm thinking, whoa, man, that is terrible. I mean, I begin to get a little self-conscious. Is that the way I look when I pull the Bible up real close? Thank you, Jesus. Isn't He good? Yes. Is He good? Yes. Is God good? Yes. And does His mercy endure for... Yes. Wait. Does His mercy endure for you? That's enough to shout about. When you can do that, then you can begin to connect with the Holy Ghost, and it's not going to be aloof from you, and you're not going to be isolated anymore, wondering, how is it do I get to flow in the Holy Spirit? How is it that I get to flow in all of these abundance of things that God has supplied in every area? Father, listen, He has it every, it all belongs to Him. All the wealth is His, and He wants to lavish that upon you.
But if you don't know how to receive from him, you never can have it.
Listen, all of his love, it belongs to him. All the love belongs to him, and he wants to lavish it upon you. All the power belongs to him. All the resources belong to him. In every area, creative power, inspiration, insight, every dimension of healing, every dimension of the miracle, every dimension of fixing things and making them right, taking that which is broken and making it whole, taking that which is weak and making it strong, taking that which is despised and rejected and at the end of itself and making it everything acceptable. And he wants to pour that upon you. He wants to pour that upon us so that we're flowing in the church, not in a human fashion. Because if we're going to stay in a human fashion, if we're going to just remain in a human framework of things, we ought to do it all differently. And then we'll do it. If we're just going to stay human, just do it differently. Because then doing it human after the human manner, we'll have the success of the Mormons. We'll have the success of just a whole bunch of people who do things without the Holy Ghost. Even in the ranks of Christianity, they do it without the Holy Ghost. But if we're going to go after functioning in that which Paul demonstrated was the life of the believer, not just the life of Jesus, but the life of the believer, then we're going to have to start doing it differently. Otherwise, we're not going to be fruitful and we're not going to be effective. Father made a way for us to connect with him. It's through the blood of Jesus Christ. And all that purpose of the blood of Jesus Christ was to bring to us this new life in him, this abundant life in him, which is the fundamental result of you and I receiving the Holy Ghost and then operating in the Holy Ghost, which you cannot if the blood is not allowed to do its work. To make you everything holy and acceptable to God 24 hours a day, success or not. If there's ever, and let me just tell you this. If you are perfectly successful in everything in God and as holy as, even as God is holy, I mean, he's made us holy and empowered us to be holy, but it's in the framework of that which he's endowed us with and imparted to us and given us. But if you were in every way impeccably holy and righteous and pure, then you wouldn't be relying upon the blood of Jesus Christ with your feeling of confidence and assurance, and you would approach unto God on the basis of your own success. And I'm going to tell you right now, that is unacceptable. I'm going to tell you right now, that is unacceptable. I said, it is unacceptable. Amen. It is unacceptable. Amen. It's unacceptable. Yes, he's given me his righteousness. I'm righteous as he is righteous. He's given me his holiness, and I'm holy even as he's holy. These are all things that he's empowered us to be. He's not obligated us to be. He's empowered us to be. And what I watch is I watch a bunch of people listen to the message of freedom and salvation and become all condemned about it. Because they've not made it about the blood of Jesus Christ. They've not made it about the mercy of God and the grace of God and the goodness of God and what Father's done on our behalf, apart from anything that we've done. They've made it about something that he's done plus something that they're doing. No. Father has done it all for us and even given to us the very life and power of it. He is the life to the being, to the soul, if you would. He's the life to our soul and spirit that the soul and spirit is to the body. Do you understand? He is the life. He's the means of it. He's the existence of it. Somehow we break this down and dichotomize, Lord, you do this and I'm going to do that and you do your part and I'm going to do my part. He does that part for us. Only when we learn to yield to him. And we're never going to yield to him in condemnation and shame and fear and threat. And I feel so discouraged. Let me just tell you, when you God begins, if you will allow God to use you, and he begins to use you in a greater way. It's like Bethany was speaking right out of the Spirit saying, listen, the only way you really can show love to Father is in your praise and your worship.
But the only way you can really show the love to the Father in praise and worship is because you're just so thankful for what He did. And in the being of so thankful for what He did for you in faith in the blood, the Holy Spirit is now free to express that through us and give us an unlimited glory so that God's people can understand in the context of worship is when you prophesy, when the prophecy begins. And I don't, Genesis all the way through the Bible, it's where prophecy begins. And we're stuck in religious, cultural things that all we want to do is sing some song that somebody else wrote. Pray some prayer that somebody else wrote. We've kind of outgrown that a bit, but my goodness, sometimes I listen to people pray and I think, well, why don't you read the prayer? Do you understand what I'm saying?
Yes.
It would probably be a little bit more theologically correct. It would probably be a little bit more inspirational and it would have a little more fluidity to it. But our fluidity should be like rivers. You know what I'm saying? Our fluidity should be like rivers. But it can be when you got condemnation and shame and fear and doubt and all that's because you've made your relationship in part, if not all, at least in part, based upon your own performance and how well you do. And really what that breaks down to is how good do you feel about yourself? And you know what? If people are walking around constantly trying to get reaffirmed because they're so insecure and asking folks, well, how do you think I did? How well did I did? That's just such insecurity. What is that from? Fear. Why don't you just dive into the God's love for you? Why don't you just dive into God's love for you? Why don't you just dive into God's love for you? Dive in. Because there's a lot of sorrowful and sad people looking at you thinking that, you know, come on. There's a lot of sorrowful and sad people looking at you thinking there might be a possibility that you know the remedy. And then they stare a little bit longer and they go, well, no, they don't know the remedy. They look as bad off as I am. They look as disappointed, upset. Where church isn't the place that it should be. Church should be the most exciting place that you go to. Why? Because Father is supposed to be uniquely revealed and manifested in His church, different from any other place anywhere at all. It's that which Christ Jesus built. It's built upon the foundation of the apostles and the prophets, Jesus Christ being the cornerstone. In other words, they're showing us how it functions, the very life and manifestation and ministry and glory and power and splendor and display of all the fullness of God, as Paul said. But if we're, listen, I'm telling you right now, if you're not willing to flow in the Holy Ghost, then let's not do Holy Ghost. Let's do it like the Baptists and the Episcopals and the Nazarenes. And everybody just kind of basically removes the Holy Ghost and does man-made fashions, man-made programs, man-made efforts that's going to appeal to the rational thinking of humanity. But if you're going to do Holy Ghost, then why don't you go all the way and understand what is essential to make that connection? What is essential to make that connection is the blood of Jesus Christ. And you say, well, why is that? Because He removes the sin, He removes the guilt, He removes the offense, He removes every sense of separation. What, one time, the first time? You know, once a month? Huh? When you've done good for 5 days and now you've failed one day? When you've done good for 5 minutes and you failed for 1 minute? When is, what is it? What is the basis by which you have all your righteousness and all your acceptance and all your holiness and all your life and all your empowerment and in a sense of communion of His love and of, because you can't receive what God is supplying unless you're receiving His love and interacting with His love and being confident and bold, which all these other things work against. So thus, it reveals the demonic power in it. God the Holy Ghost isn't a condemner. God, the Holy Ghost isn't a guilt, you know, provider. He's not one who constantly tries to help us deal with our sense of self-worth, our self-accomplishments. He's the one who's always showing us Jesus.
Look at how Father feels about you.
You know that? That's what He does. He said,
Holy Ghost, look at how Father feels about you.
And He's not pointing to you or anything. He's saying,
look at Jesus. That's how Father feels about you. Look at how Father feels about you. Look at Jesus.
You go, whoa. And for like, you know, for a long time, you're just standing going, it can't be true. This is, can it be true?
Is that really how it is? Am I performing right? Did I make A's today? Did I outrun everybody in the race? Oh, I feel I'm doing pretty good. You know, I feel I'm doing pretty good. I made B's this quarter. But I need to do better. We've been twisted. We've been messed up. And that stuff has got, former conversation has got to be busted off. Yeah. And what's worse is then the way that you let God, the way you think about how God feels about you and the way you interact with Him, then that's how you treat everybody else.
Yeah.
Yuck. Huh? Yeah. And when you walk up to hug people, come here, baby. When you walk up to hug people, you don't do this, but it kind of feels this way to other people. Love you. Feels that way. Actually, it might be, I think I'm trying to love you. I'm doing this because the pastor said so. Let's not do that.
No.
So we said, please tell me how not to do that. Can you help me? Yes. Turn to Jesus.
Amen.
Let His blood be the provision and the means for all of your empowerment and all of your acceptance. Because when you do that, you're going to be start acting like me and more.
Amen.
You're going to have a freedom. You're going to have a boldness. Yes. You're going to have a confidence. Yes. Yes. You can never flow in the Holy Ghost without boldness and confidence.
Yeah.
You can never get up and do what Bethany just did without a boldness and a confidence and a certainty. An empowerment. You always feel like, oh, I'm going to do it wrong. Oh, they're going to think it's wrong. And now you do what you do based upon you and what everybody else thinks. Nobody needs to hear that anyways. But you need to get over that, because otherwise you're just going to be a Nazarene for the rest of your life. A denominational one. A Baptist for the rest of your life. A denominational one. Stuck over here in a Holy Ghost center with a Holy Ghost man looking at you going, what? Why don't you just... There's a whole lot better fun for you to be having instead of functioning in you. Why don't you function in God?
Amen.
It's a whole lot more fun. You don't have to pretend. You don't have to try to conjure something up. And conjure's the word. You know, today's the conjuring day, right? It's the new moon. It's when they conjure, cast spells. Just so happened to fall on Sunday, this, I bind every foul spirit of hell. Too many of God's people being influenced by it. Worse things than that. Huh?
Yes.
Too many people, God's people are being influenced by all these things that have nothing to do with the reality of the love of God, the goodness of God, the results of the blood, the functioning of the Holy Ghost. Why is it then we will allow it? Because if we would stop and think, wait a minute, I'm allowing things to be expressed in my life that doesn't look like heaven. Then at that moment, at that first moment, we would begin to be able to ask God to give us insight and wisdom to stop it, to shut it down.
Yeah.
You know, there's times I talk to people about their issues and their problems, and they say, well, one of the first things that come out of my mouth, and I'll say, what is it, how is it that you're going to do things differently from here on in? And every once in a while, I'll hear somebody give a true word and an expression of wisdom out of their mouth, and they'll say, well, my first step was to acknowledge my wrongdoing. To be able to see it. I wasn't even aware of what I'm telling you right now, last month. That is the first step. To say, wait a minute, I've got things going on being expressed in my life. And we want to talk about the worst and the crude and all of the things. But the results of the worst and the crude basically equals what many people are doing based on the basis of just their own, you know, wrong approach to God. A religious posture before God. How well did I do? Mm-hmm. Lord, have you been adding up my total points now? And are you grading on the bell curve? Because I've been looking around. I think I'm doing pretty good. I don't really feel good about myself in comparison to you. But based on everybody else, how am I doing? What am I? You know, am I in a situation here on the bell curve where a 48% actually is an A because everybody else is 35? And any other standard, you'd totally be failing, but because you're with a bunch of other stupid people, you know, you're in it. You know what I'm saying? Or you know, not necessarily. I just use that word. I like to use that word because it's a shock word. I love shock words. I love words that people go, what? Are you talking bad about me again? Yeah. Can we just talk bad about you to the point that we just kind of like short circuit you and it doesn't exist anymore? Just we just drain you of you and now you can say, I'm in Christ. I'm in him. And there's a lot of the stuff that comes along and challenges me being in Christ Jesus and Christ Jesus being in me, but I don't care. I'm going to be in him and I'm hallelujah. And I'm not going to feel good about me anymore. I'm going to feel good about him. Hallelujah. I feel so good about him. Hallelujah. Some people, I didn't run today. I don't feel good about myself. Are you kidding me? Your value and your worth is based upon whether you ran. I slept in today. I slept until 10. Ann and I slept until 10. What was it? 10, like 10, 10, 10, 15. I mean, we haven't done this in years. I felt so good about myself. I'm like, wow. We haven't slept in like this, but just the other day. Same thing, they sleep in, they feel terrible about themselves all day long. What's wrong? I slept in, man. I feel just like such a loser. Oh man, I tell you, I feel so terrible. I've been making $85,000 a year for the past 20 years. I feel so terrible about myself. Well, why is that? Could you help me understand? Because I should be making, for the past 20 years, I should be making like $250,000 a year now. I've got some friends who are making even more than that. Are you kidding me? Did you tell me that you were born again? That you were washed in the blood? That God had given you his very own life? That he himself keeps you, that he rises up early taking care of you before you get up, that you've been given the riches of heaven, blessed with all spiritual blessings, that the power of the Holy Ghost is on the inside of you like a wellspring flowing in the river. And what is it that you're telling me right now? I can't even believe I'm hearing this.
It's the status quo. It's where people are at.
I can't believe it. I'm just a loser Christian. I haven't brought anybody to Jesus since I was born again 50 years ago. Well, you know, that is something to feel bad about. But the reality of it is, you probably have been stuck in one thing or the other that's brought you to this point. So you're going to have to quit feeling bad about things. Because the only way anybody's going to ever be able to see somebody touched by the power of God is because they've learned how to flow in the Holy Ghost. If you don't know how to flow in the anointing of the Holy Ghost, no, you will not reach anyone for the kingdom of God. There are many of God's people who could count on one hand, who've been in the church a long time, how many people they brought into the kingdom of God. And yeah, I mean, if there's anything worthwhile feeling bad about yourself, that would be it. But you're going to have to just let that go and recognize that you've got this love and relationship, this goodness of God being poured out upon you abundantly, not because of who you are or what you've done, but because of who he is and what he's done. And if you'll, because reality of it is most people are in that situation because they've gone from one issue that has sinners around them because they've exalted themselves. Covetousness is a terrible thing and it has many different dimensions in which it influences and infects. I don't like to say affect, because infect is a far better word. It does affect you, but it infects you. It's a disease, and the only cure is his love. Amen. And the only way you get and I get to connect with his love is through this precious blood. Lord, you are my righteousness. My heart is fixed on you, and I worship you. Hallelujah. Huh? That way I wake up in the morning, God, you're so amazing. Now I'm free to flow. I'm free to flow. At the end of the day, I don't count up. Okay, get the list out. Three categories, spiritually, physically, and financially. How well did I do? Holiness, check. Righteousness, check. Friendly to everybody? Mediocre.
And then when I go through the list, now I'm going. Now, and I get a total number. If it is above 50, you may worship. If it is below 50, go to bed feeling bad. And hope you do better tomorrow. Think about it, people. You're doing it. You're doing it. Fear and self-worth and self-evaluation on that level keeps you from moving with God. To connect with Father's love, you connect with His love through the blood. Lord, You are my righteousness. Put my trust in You and worship You. It is just there. And then the connecting, and because you connect with God's love through the precious blood of Jesus, then you're able to now be liberated in Him so the Spirit of the Lord can flow and function through your life. In all the dimensions of healing and in all the dimensions of grace and all the dimension of goodness, but especially praise and worship where I'm singing in the Spirit. I just did a book. I'm just praising God for it and praying that everybody will read it and want it. On tongues, the language of the Holy Ghost. And then everyone will start going, recognizing, wait a minute, I can sing in the Spirit. And here's Paul. I will sing in the Spirit when there's a right music leader. There's relationship. I'll pray in the Spirit when there's a right, you know, prayer leader. It's relationship. Out of the overflow of His goodness. There are things that I want God to do in my life that haven't been revealed or haven't been manifested. I'd like for my eyes to be more perfect. Yes, doesn't it impact me at all on how He feels about me and what I'm going to do? There are things I would have liked to accomplish that I haven't accomplished, but it has no impact whatsoever in my relationship with Him and how He feels about me and how I feel about Him and what He's going to be allowed to do through me. It has no impact at all. I'm not making anything else a description of how God feels about me and how I interact with Him other than the cross of Calvary, other than Jesus Christ's blood poured out for me. Now, and I pray that everybody that's shaking their head yes and that is saying yes, that you'll be consecrated to doing it because you haven't been doing it. But if you don't recognize you haven't been doing it, then nothing will ever change. Because when you do it, a release of the Holy Ghost flow will come through your life, unless you don't believe in the Holy Ghost. So I have to pare this thing down. It's either this or it's this. It can't be, it's not this other thing over here. It's this or this. Because the Lord has lavished this upon us. He made it simple how we could have a wellspring and then describe what the wellspring looks like. And so if we don't have the description of the wellspring, then there's a problem. So what is it? He made it so simple as to how the rivers of God would flow. And He described perfectly what the rivers of God look like. And if it's not flowing through us, then we've got to understand, wait a minute, something has plugged the well up. Something has stopped the flow. And my job is to bring people to repentance. My job is to bring people to a place that whatever it is that's stopping the grace and the goodness of God from being manifested in their life, that it can't go on any longer. But you've got to let me. And that self-defense thing comes up. That's exactly what I'm talking about. That's why you can't flow. And that's why you can't hear, because the self-defense thing just came up. And see how it just works, coming and going. It's just so convoluted. It blocks you out of the flow of the Holy Ghost. It blocks you out from the correction of the Word, huh? And what you have to do is sometimes people say, I just don't see it. I just don't understand it. Well, read the Bible and hunger for what's in the Bible. And then you're going to say, oh God, what can doth hinder me? And then you're going to get to see. Because if there's anything that needs to be in our heart and passion is to want to be a part of a glorious church, because that's what Father purchased when He gave His only begotten Son. That's what Jesus purchased with His own blood.
that if we're willing to be anything other than a glorious church flowing in the wonderful baptism of God's presence and glory, which has an expression that has an expression of all those things that God described, and it's happening in each person, and it's not limited to just one manifestation, but that all of them are available, but have any one of them. It's like people say, well, we all had tongues. Well, praise God, but you need to excel. Praise God that there was one manifestation of the Holy Ghost in your life, and it's Pentecost. You've got one manifestation. Many churches have one manifestation of God's grace in their life, of the Holy Ghost, and it's the first 5 seconds of Pentecost. Can we go on to the first hour? Could we go on into the first 24 hours of Pentecost? How about the first week of Pentecost? Could we advance to the first year of Pentecost?
Yeah.
But the first year, shadows, you know, are healing people.
Yeah.
Shadows. The shadows. That's what Pentecost brought. Pentecost brought the display of all God's power and signs and wonders. Must we stay in the first 5 seconds of Pentecost and feel good about ourselves? It ain't about feeling about ourselves, right? That's the problem. They that compare themselves among themselves aren't wise. I want you to look at a very familiar story with me in Genesis chapter 19. And here we got, you know, Lot had it going on, but you know what? One problem led to the next. He was allowing strife in his life, and he was allowing it to go on in his household, and he wouldn't shut it down. And I promise you, there was plenty of opportunity for him to shut that strife down. But the strife got so bad that Abraham had to say, look, you know what? This, you know, and he was really talking about sin. He's look, it just can't go on. The strife cannot go on. It's better for us to part now than the strife. Because I kind of fill in the blanks a little bit. I could just see Abraham saying, this thing's going to go to murder. Somebody's going to get killed here. This thing is getting completely out of hand, the strife. So one sin and one failure of Lot leads to another. And then out of that midst of that sin and that transgression that he doesn't want to get right, and believe me, it was strife. Listen to me. The smallest act of transgression and sin will ultimately bring man to ultimate ruin, to the point that they want to do away with God altogether. That is very clearly witnessed in the Bible. One act of transgression in which Adam partook of that which God told him not to. One act, simple little act, results in the end, in the book of Revelation, where men want to completely do away with God altogether. That's the full ruin and consequence of sin in each individual's life, not just collectively, but in each individual's life, if it's allowed to continue on. Strife had its beginning in Lot's life. He was not willing to deal with it. I'm certain that Abraham set him down on a number of occasions and said, listen, I see these things going on, these problems going on. You're going to have to nip it in the bud because it's just going to get worse. But he never did anything with it. And then out of that small area, if you would, strife is a huge area anyways, no matter how you look at it. Then he's got a choice to make of how he's going to now live his life, seeing as he doesn't want to deal with the strife in his household. Now, how are you going to deal with your life? And so he's going to look around and he's going to cast his eye upon all the various different opportunities, and his eye is going to be covetous. His eye is going to be covetous. He's going to want things that somebody else provided and that he himself is not going to have to labor to get. He's looking at the plains of the city. He's going to look for protection now that he doesn't have to rely upon God to receive. There's just a whole long litany of things, or a list of things that you could list with respect to Lot and why he looks at the plains in Sodom and Gomorrah as the place where he wants to set up his home. It's going to be a whole lot easier. It's living in town. It's living where the grocery stores are at. It's living where, you know, it could go on and on and on. And Abraham goes, wait a minute, you better watch it. You better watch it. Ultimately, he doesn't take any instruction at all. He's just self-confident. He's going to do it on his own. Uncle Abe, what really does Uncle Abe know anyways? You know, yeah, he's got this relationship with God, but look where it's got him. He's still walking around in tents. I want him to do something better with my life, you know. I'm going to go down to the city, and who knows, I could be governor overnight. Who knows what all was going on? But you know, classically, all human beings are the same. You know, they got the same thing going on in the jungle of the Congo that they have going on downtown New York. Same exact thing. It just played out in a different way. Same exact inspiration on the inside. Now it ultimately comes to the place
where all of his family is completely ruined. All of his family is completely ruined. Ruined. It's his fault. Ruined. There's no one left. He's even tweaked. He's even totally messed up. He's willing to take his daughters and throw them out to evil and wicked men. He's so tweaked. Here's the angel of the Lord who can take care of everything. He's so far removed from supernatural power, the power of God, the ability to trust in God, to even recognize how much authority and power God has, that he's going to mitigate on behalf of God. And that mitigation is going to be, well, these violent, evil men want to have their way with these messengers of God, which, you know, is God. God showed up at Sodom and Gomorrah. And so what he's going to do is he's going to turn his two girls out to be just absolutely raped and abused on every kind of level. He's tweaked, man. Are you going to tell me he deserves anything? One situation after another situation after another situation. How is it that the angels are even down there, even concerned about him? And he's not sure that he wants to be delivered. They're just sitting there waiting around. God's saying, look, I'm going to destroy the place. You need to go now. And they're just kind of looking at each other, uncertain as to whether or not they even want to be saved. Are you listening to me? Yes. Is this crazy or what? Yes. And his wife is really, does she even want to go nowhere?
No, she does.
Huh? And we know what that, we know how tweaked the girls are, because we're going to see what they're going to do with the, we're going to see what kind of ruin they're going to produce with God's grace and mercy in their life. The point that I want to make is that God doesn't do things because we deserve. And you're going to find out right here in Genesis chapter 19, where the first place that the word mercy is even used in the Bible. There's three predominant words for mercy. And all of them have, at the very heart of it, compassion, loving kindness, forgiveness. No matter which Hebrew word you're dealing with for mercy, they have right at the heart of them loving kindness, compassion, forgiveness. And here, the Lord's going to use two words for mercy that are properly translated mercy, that are deeply enriched with forgiveness, compassion, and loving kindness. And Lot hasn't even asked to be forgiven. I wonder if anybody in here is going to take hold of mercy of God. I wonder if anybody is going to recognize that right at the center of relationship, the revelation of God's relationship and the opportunity to come into his presence is all about mercy. And that's why he calls the lid to the top, or the cover to the Ark of the Covenant, the mercy seat. Where God's going to meet with us is at the very hearts of mercy. Depths of mercy, and there in the depths of mercy, he's going to provide purgation. In the depths of mercy, he's going to provide forgiveness. In the depths of mercy, he's going to provide grace. In the depths of mercy, he's going to provide the provision wherein he is able to dwell in our midst, and we're able to dwell in his midst. And that's the foundation. That's the Old Testament. That's the foundation of what has brought us to something even so far greater that somehow people are not, Pentecostals are not willing to go there. So they're looking for remedies, so they're going to go to hyper grace. That'll help them a little bit. Help them some. Help them some. Might help you some. Maybe you should go to a hyper grace church for the next 2-3 years and then come back. Huh? You know, just get grace, 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 mercy, mercy, mercy. Huh? Whatever it takes to get you get excited about Jesus. And make all of your righteousness in his blood, make all of your worthiness in his blood. Get so excited about his goodness. Yes. Because there he's going to unveil who he is as you recognize what he's done. As you accept it and receive it, begin to respond to it. Oh, my, 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 my. I pray in Jesus' name. I am so earnest for revival to come. I am so earnest to see a glorious church function in the wonderful outworking of the Holy Ghost, the display of the Holy Ghost. I'm not interested, says the Lord, in songs and singing. I'm not interested, says the Lord, in preaching and all of this teaching and ministry. That's what God says. That's what he says. But that's what we want. That's the way we want to have it, because we want to have a program. Well, if we want to have a program, then let's get fully over into the program and really make it count and do something big with it.
Yeah.
I personally am not going to do that, but I am challenging you to get on one side or the other. Get on the side of what God has done for you or what you're going to do for him. Get on one side or the other. Hallelujah. And I'm telling you what you're going to do for him being on that side. You're going to be just as grumpy and lack of joy and lack of flow of the Holy Ghost as any other religious group in history has been. Not showing forth his goodness, not showing forth his glory. And I pray in the name of Jesus that today you'll understand these things even in a more in a more perfect way, so that you can begin to let God have his way. That flow of the soparo to bikim bravatan lo kukin and a kikita musideli pikatasta then flows over into the realms of prophecy and flows over into the realms of that which causes each person who comes into the place to recognize what's going on in their life and the secrets of their heart being revealed. And they fall down and begin to worship God. The destaraman causes you to connect with a greater dimension of the display of God's love, where your face is lit up with this divine presence and glory. Because it's a hookup realm. The blood is a hookup realm. The blood hooks us up to all that Father has provided for us in relationship. And the Holy Spirit hooks us up with all that Father has provided for us in the display of his power and his glory. But there's no hookup with the Holy Ghost until the hookup of the blood has been settled and it is placed in your life. There's a manifestation as to whether or not the blood of Jesus Christ has really been placed in your life in the way that it should be. There's no more sense of sin. There's no more conscience of offense. There's no more thought of or action or behavior that somehow you're aloof from God and he's far away from you and somehow he doesn't care for you or love you the way he does love you. Go ahead. I'd like to have tongue interpretation, tongue right now. It's a perfect time. I can feel it. Go ahead. The message in tongue and the interpretation of it. Because that's church. That's the way the Lord did church. And there should be at least two or three. Paul was trying to rein them in to just, say, wait, do two or three, then have an interpretation of tongue. Of course, the most optimal is to have interpretation, have a tongue and have an interpretation of tongue. But at least it could be two or three, and then once that's done, go to the next one. And let there begin to be the expression of divine glory, not through one man, but through all of God's people. That is a place of redemption and justification. That is a place of confidence and boldness in God. There's a place where faith is free to flow through our lives. Hallelujah. And we want to bring you there. We want to get rid of your false models. And that can happen because you're so desperate. You begin to wear the responsibility to recognize that these things must be in the church. And the only person you have power over is yourself. And so you're going to start yielding yourself to the Holy Ghost in such a way that he has the freedom to express the things that he's already written in his word. You don't have to guess about. He's revealed them. He says, this is what's supposed to be doing. My heart should say, that's what I'm going to be doing.
Yes.
I want them, and if I don't have them, I don't understand how to move in them. If there's a place of sickness or disease in my life and I don't know how to get healed, I'm going to lay hold on God because faith doesn't take no for an answer. Yeah. And that's proven over and again. And Father has made it very clear that it is his desire to heal us. It is his desire that he's the one who
heals all of our diseases and cleanses all of our iniquities. Do you, Father wants you to believe it. He wants you to believe it tomorrow morning. Hallelujah. He wants you to believe it right now. There's no place in time that you're supposed to believe and express what you believe as in the church. And people look so sad and sorrowful.
You know, you're sitting in a meeting like this the whole time. Then at the end of the meeting, you say, have you ever asked Jesus in your life? Oh, yeah, I love him. Been walking with him for a long time. You got to be kidding me, man. That's a false stinking witness, man. It has nothing to do with the reality of what God showed in his word concerning his people. You a liar. Capital L. Change. Because God's people aren't sitting around with a frown and a critical heart and a suspicious spirit and a disagreeing attitude. They are people that are full of his love, hungry for more, with teachable spirits, desiring to lay hold on everything that the Word of God describes, rather than trying to self-justify and say, I don't need that in my life today because a preacher told me it's passed away.
Come on.
And you know what? To me, what's worse than the people who believe that somehow all that God has described has passed away? Those people who believe that it hasn't and still don't have it. That's worse. You have more right to exist in your behavior to believe that it's something God gave, but it's passed away, rather than to believe that it still exists today, but you don't have it. What's your excuse? Now what's your excuse? Because everybody's got another excuse. Get rid of them.
Yes.
Get captivated by Jesus. Get caught up in that which the blood of Jesus Christ supplies, and you will immediately have the flow of the Holy Ghost, because that's how easy Jesus made it. Look at the gift of God, he says to the woman at the well, and out of your belly will begin to flow a wellspring. People, I want you to understand. I want you to understand. This is what God, the Holy Ghost, has to say. And it's high time that you agree with it and you quit justifying a behavior and fighting with the messenger. Yes. Quit justifying a behavior that is not in any way revealed in Scripture. Because it's just going to make you fight with the anointing and fight with the Holy Ghost. And you don't want to live that way. Because all it's going to be is a false representation, and you're never going to have the joy. And you're never going to have the love. And you're never going to have the Holy Ghost flow. And you're just going to be a religious Christian that looks like they're in pain. And that everything is going bad. And then you go and tell people that you are a signpost for heaven, describing the goodness of God. You are manifestly declared by God, this is what it looks like. Your epistle written by the Lord describing his goodness and the results of salvation. Does heaven look like you? Does a relationship with a Father look like what you're expressing and what's going on in your life? Because that's what God demands.
Yes.
That's what he demands, because that's what he's provided. He's provided that which he demands. Anything less is a false witness. And I know how Father feels about false witnesses. And I'm not going to be in that area. And I'm not going to be in that category. You know what? I know how he feels about his people walking around in fullness of joy. He said it over and again. So I tell you right now, I would have a responsibility that if there was no joy around, I'd act like it. But you know what? I don't have to act like it, because Father has supplied it without measure, without limit. But if I somehow had something imposing upon me that it didn't look like joy, I'm going to have joy, because I recognize that there is no greater testimony that I've been born again and that I have the Holy Spirit at work in my life and that I'm yielded to him than joy. But yet God's people will come in to the most important celebration of the day, of the week, and they will look less than full of joy, joy unspeakable and full of glory, because you're not willing to participate with God, because something somewhere along the way has made this your supposed relationship other than Jesus. He's made it something else other than the blood that has redeemed you and washed you and cleansed you. And I say, stop it. From this day forward, I say, stop it now. I told somebody the other day, you asked me, say, Pastor, please look into my life. I said, well, you know, you just need to be happy and rejoicing, especially on church days. And I said, so, and his wife was with him. And so I said, listen, I tell you, have this consecration. Why don't you go out and buy a makeup kit that they use at the circus? And if there's no way for you to connect with Joy, have her just put a big, huge clown smile on your face to where that nobody can tell that you're frowning. Hey, and then there's this like little lip plug that you can put in. It goes over, superimposed upon your lips, and it's smiling too. And if you had that much commitment to be a proper representation of Jesus, because his, the new covenant, sorrow and sighing fled away, there is no more frowns. You didn't bring an offering acceptable unto the Lord, and it looked like... No. Because he said over and again, over and over again. More than 500 times, the Lord made it very clear about how he expects that anybody who knows the Lord is going to be happy. Of course, it's the truth. To know that you're redeemed, that your name's written in the Lamb's Book of Life, that God is keeping you, that he's pouring out upon you his love and his mercy, that you're the most important person to him in the universe, so to speak, that a mother can forget her nursing child, but Father's never going to forget you, that he's going to watch over you, protect you, keep you, he's going to perfect everything that concerns you, he's going to be before you and behind you and fill you and live inside of you, and he's not going to let any evil thing come nigh your dwelling. I mean, my goodness, how can he be? And then you see the same people on Sunday, and then you see them out in the parking lot smiling. I want to slap that person. That's where I have to round up. I have to grab my mercy. I just say, Lord, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. They don't realize they just brought the offering of joy to some human being but failed to give it to you. They don't realize they just got happy because now they're playing their favorite video game. And they couldn't bring any joy to you. So there's some people in here right now that need to be repenting because I know how I function in the word of knowledge when I'm preaching. Some people are just so excited and so radiant of joy over their own performance and over what they've done. Oh, wasn't that amazing? Did you see that? When I did that really, really, whatever. Did you? But when they come to church, it's like, there's no inspiration. And Father beholds it and he sees it. And that should impact you more than anybody else seeing it, more than... You know, and more than the preacher getting in your face and saying, look, what you've been doing is wrong. Stop doing it now. That's right. Don't you just hate it when people alter their behavior when somebody else is around? You know, you know them, and then somebody else comes around, and they're out, they start acting different. You're like, dude, you're weird. Well, what's wrong? What are you saying that for? Because you were just acting totally different just before so-and-so showed up. What's up with this? What's going on between you two? There's not a lot of people who get real like that. I like to get real like that. I like to just kind of poke a hole in the bubble. What? What's up? Why are you doing this? And you watch people do that spiritually. Oh, somebody's come to church, I can't speak in tongues? Because they don't understand? Who cares what they understand, man? And bringing, they don't understand nothing. Huh? Where I usually dance around and worship, but now so-and-so, my boss has come to church, and now I... All that stuff is easily removed when God fills you, when he fills your view. He wants to fill your view. Someone said, I want him to fill my view. Well, start acting like it. Because if you do, if you start interacting with him like that, I'm going to tell you right now, he's going to say, wow, this person really is sincere about me. They love me. And my child really cares about me. They want only my influence in their life. I'm going to give them more. I'm going to show them more. I'm going to reveal more to them. I love the way I preach. And I might as well, because I probably like one of the few. It's okay. I don't care. I'm going to do what God's telling me to do. I'm going to get in the face of people making a mockery out of divine grace, making a mockery out of His salvation, of this wonderful joy and love and this celebration that's supposed to be in our heart and say, they disqualify. Don't look at them.
That's right.
Yeah. Posing.
Yeah.
And for why and for what? I have no idea. You know, right? Person comes out to the beach and got a surfboard and got it all made up. I can understand why they're posing. Let me find the verse. Is everybody with me here in Genesis 19? I have a hard time seeing over here in this realm of divine glory. There it is, 9:16. It was broken up between the page. And while he lingered, the men laid hold upon his hands. Look, they're saying, guys, we've got to go now. First of all, these guys did not even deserve nothing. They were as messed up as the rest of the people pretty much in the place. Are you with me?
Yeah.
But God in His mercy is going to come and intervene on their behalf, because there's one person interceding for them. It's just, you know, it's the power of prayer. It's the power of relationship and covenant relationship. They're not even willing to go. So God grabs them, lays hold on them, and so to speak, dragging them out of the place, and laid hold upon his wife and laid hold upon his daughters. Now listen to this. And while they were yet lingering, they're really not made up mind. They don't really even want to be, know if they want to be saved. They don't even know if they're believing what's going on. They're not, they have no ears to hear. Their hearts have hardened. And he lays hold upon his hands. And he lays hold upon the hands of his wife. And he lays hold upon the hands of the two daughters. The Lord being merciful. That right there is the first time this word is ever found in the Bible. It sets precedence to cause you to understand that when you read about God's mercies that are new every morning, it's God giving to us something that we absolutely don't deserve, so you can go get ahead and get excited and happy about Him. Even if you came in here frowning and sorrowful and sad, and He's laying hold on you and trying to bring you into happy land. Oh, yeah. And you're still lingering. Well, I'm telling you, I have a reason to be sad. You can't believe it. My toast was burned this morning. And we know how Father feels about it with this priest. He tells Aaron, don't you cry for those boys. They justly were taken out. They were justly were judged and died. Don't you put on a sad countenance. You get happy. Get your happy face on right now. Hey?
Yes.
And then no sorrowing. No sighing. Don't act like I've done wrong. Huh? Don't act like I've been unjust. I there's so many things to say on this, but I'm going to go ahead real quickly and just jump over there with me to Hebrews chapter 7, verse 25. There's so much to say about God's goodness and God's mercy. Oh, Hebrews. Hebrews is like the Leviticus, you know, of the New Testament. Before you go to Hebrews, just look in Ezekiel. Pardon me, forgive me. Exodus. Exodus, Judges, 3:4. I'm just so full of the Borosia to Manekeva. And in the Namongareya. Do I look sad?
No.
Have I modeled sorrow?
No.
Have I been a leader in affliction and torment? Well, then submit yourself and follow the leadership.
Yeah.
Hook up with what we're doing in God.
Yeah.
If we're not doing what God said to do, then don't follow us. But if we're doing His joy, if we're doing His love, if we're hungry and thirsty for the things of the kingdom, if we're placing a demand upon those things which God has commanded, why persecute us? Why act as though somehow we are asking or demanding things that are not right?
Because it's just, you know, it doesn't, that wouldn't make any sense. It doesn't make any sense. Father has purposed that you and I have this glory flow through our life so that it may be proven that Jesus is the resurrection and that he's the light, that he's the ruler, he's the sovereign ruler right now. He's the baptizer in the Holy Ghost right now. He's pouring out all these wonderful things from on high to everybody who will receive. And it's all about just believing what he's done for us and finding all our righteousness in him and all our holiness in him and all of our confidence in him and all of our boldness in him and not making our lives because, you know, if about anything else, because if you give your life to condemnation and shame and sorrow and doubt and confusion all week long, that's all you're going to have to bring. And you got to stop it. And if it's a stronghold, then let us pray over you. If you've got a stronghold in your life, then let God give you the remedy for your breakthrough so that that demon power can't influence you any longer. If you can't have joy, if you can't have joy, then God says you can't be a leader in the church. You can't be. You can't be an example of Christ if you don't know how to walk in joy and love and celebration. If you don't know how to flow in the Holy Ghost, you have no right to say, I'm a leader in the church. Because then you made yourself a double false witness. And that's why the scripture says, let there be not many teachers among you, knowing that they will receive the greater condemnation. And then it's true greater condemnation. Because it's a double false witness. People want to think that you can do things based upon what other men recommend. No, it's what God the Holy Spirit supplies and you and I receiving it. Come on, people. How hard is it to flow in prophecy? It's not hard at all. You just got to be willing to yield to the Holy Spirit. And it's got to start tomorrow morning and work all week. And that's going to simply be about you saying, here's what yielding to the Holy Spirit is. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for your precious blood that has brought me into this place. Oh, God, I'm just captivated by you, for you're just all day feeling good about him. Yes. And when you're all day feeling good about him, you know, there's going to be a, you're going to feel good about yourself, I reckon. If self is still so big there. But you're going to feel good about him to the point where you're just living in him and you no longer live. You're crucified with Christ, nevertheless you live, but not you. It's Christ Jesus that lives. Hallelujah. I'm in him. Lord, I just thank you so much that I'm in you right now. And being in you causes us joy. And being in you causes me to be able to easily flow in all the display of your power and your glory. Look there in Exodus 34. In verse 6, the Lord says, this is who I am. Verse 6, right?
Yes.
This is who I am. This is who I am. I'm the one who's full of loving kindness. I'm the one who's full of compassion. I'm the one who's full of mercy. Look at God describing himself. That's everything you and I need right there.
Yeah.
That's everything we, when we all of a sudden understand the use of loving kindness and mercy, those two words are actually two of the words, the Hebrew words there that are used in this verse of scripture, and they're translated differently and obviously in different translations. But two of the words, loving kindness and mercy, that is there are the words used in Exodus 9, in Genesis chapter 19. That goes and drags Lot and his family out of Sodom and Gomorrah. God doing something for man that they absolutely do not deserve. And the Lord passed by before him and proclaimed, Yahweh, I am Yahweh Eloheinu. I am merciful. I am gracious. I am long-suffering. And I am abundant in loving kindness. Come on! Come on. Come, give me a break. I mean, the Lord brought the fullness of all of that right here in the midst of the new covenant. Full of grace and loving kindness. Full of grace and truth or loving kindness.
And that was a perfect opportunity for you to praise the Lord for a little while. I mean, just praise Him. Thank you, Lord. I mean, come on, just praise Him for just a little while. Let me train you. Just praise Him for a little while. Just quit being despondent. Don't be despondent. Be responsive. So you can be responsible. Amen. Thank you, Father. You're amazing. It's okay to say, Lord, I don't get it. But I want to. The high-mindedness of men will never say, I don't get it. The pride of life will never say, I don't get it. Because then they have to lower themselves below what they have made themselves to be. Amen. And that is ridiculous. And I pray that there is nobody in this building listening to behaving that way. That I'm really talking to somebody on the web right now or on YouTube. Oh, but you've got to learn to be responsive to God. To say, wow. Otherwise, you're just going to sit always stuck in a rut of being despondent. And it never becomes a living reality because it never became something that moved your tongue and your mouth and your spirit. The life of God is to our soul what our soul is to our body. You hear me? The life of God, the Spirit of the living God, is to our spirit and our soul what our spirit and soul is to our body. Without the Spirit of the living God, our spirit and soul is despondent. It's dead. It's or just. Let it not be. Let it not be. Let it not be. Let the riches of His grace take hold of you. Come on, people. Let the riches of His grace take hold of you. Don't nod. Praise. You know. Say something. Say something. Say something. This is speech therapy. Speech therapy. Speech development class. That's good. That's good. That's good. Look, when God displays His mercy, don't sit there and look like Lot and his wife and the two daughters lingering, hesitant, saying, oh no, what am I supposed to do now? What am I supposed to do? No. Say something that might be wrong. Don't say something that might be wrong. Fear, oppression, condemnation, shame. Performance-based Christianity. I behave based upon what I think everybody wants to see and hear. Behave based upon what Father wants to see and hear.
Yes.
Hallelujah. 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 Oh, prong dong dong ding ding. Prong dong dong ding dong ding. Shoot. Hallelujah. Hold on, no say. Now, let me just say this. If you expect the world's not going to have any problem with it. They're going to go, cool, something's happening around here. Religion is going to despise it. Religion will despise it. Like Michael, the daughter of Saul, when David began to move in the realms of the Holy Ghost and began to dance as he danced, she despised it. Everything about the moving of the Holy Ghost will be despised by religion. It will be despised. They will dance to the music of the world. They will shout to the sports demons and sports gods of society. But they know nothing about being moved by the Holy Ghost. They know nothing about the power of the Spirit of the Lord coming upon them that causes them to outrun the chariot of Ahab. Hallelujah. They know nothing about dance. They know nothing about real dance. Real dancing in the Holy Ghost. They know nothing about it. They will dance for the world and then try to make a doctrine and say, I'm religious because I say don't go dance at the world's music. And they have no ability to understand the glorious dance that God gives, the jump dance. It's a different kind of a dance. You say, oh, that's weird. It's weird to you because you're religious. It's not weird to the world. It's only weird to religious, Christian religious people. It's it. And I feel sorry for you. Because you know the way of God, but you never come in. And then everywhere there's a manifestation of the Holy Ghost, you persecute it because of the Antichrist spirit that is in you. See, anti-God, anti-anointing. And it's provable. It's not subjective. It's very objective. It's provable. It's provable. It's the Word of God that proves all things. His Word is absolute truth. His Word is absolute revelation, not only to us, but all revelation for everything around us. It's a light that shines and illuminates. It divides good from evil, right from wrong. It divides that which is belongs to Him and those things that don't belong to Him. But it divides the difference between truth and a lie, a false spirit and a true spirit. This is who Father says He is. And He's always going to be this way. He's not going to change. And furthermore, He's almighty. He's all powerful. There's no power greater than His power. So there's no power that can make Him be different. There's no power. Oh, you listen to me. You listen to me. One moment after you breathe out your last breath, it's all going to be revealed. I promise you, I am going to advance into a greater display of worship and excitement. I promise you, I will advance into a greater display of worship and excitement. The moment I breathe out my last breath, I am going to get promoted into a greater display of worship. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Can you just look at just a couple of other exciting verses of Scripture with me? In the midst of lamentation, what a place to find a declaration. And it's of God's mercy. In the midst of everything, God's just judgment's coming, because God's just judgments will come. People, you're never going to be free and liberated to enjoy all the good things of God until you receive His salvation. But I'm going to tell you right now, one day, and when you're liberated into salvation, you're empowered then to go ahead and live it out. Those who don't live it out and won't receive it, there's a certain day of judgment coming, to where right now mercy rejoices over judgment. It rejoices over the things of sin and iniquity that men have done in violation against God, when in reality they were empowered to live in His holiness and His purity and His goodness. But right now His mercy rejoices over judgment.
His mercy is there, crying out to people with his long suffering, with his loving kindness. But one day, for sure, judgment is going to come. And you're going to give an account for how you behaved yourself in the house of God. You're going to give an account for how you behaved yourself in the world around you that you're supposed to shine as light. And your very lifestyle would be a rebuke and a reproof to all of those in darkness, all of those under the grip of the power of sin. One day judgment is going to surely come and it be executed, and it will be an eternal consequence. It will not be something that somehow there will be an escape from. But in the midst of this lamentation, in the midst of this judgment that is poured out because God had come to an end in his long suffering of dealing with Israel as a nation, they would not repent. They only grew worse. They became more stubborn in their behavior. In the midst of all of this judgment, Jeremiah says in verse 21 of chapter 3, "This I recall to my mind, therefore have I hope." Suddenly I've remembered who God is. In the midst of this judgment, in the midst of this catastrophe, in the midst of this thing that would pull me down to wonder, is there anybody going to remain alive? Will there be anyone who finds grace in his sight? Will there be anyone who will be able to continue on walking with him? Then I remembered, it is of the Lord's mercies. Yes. Nothing that we deserve. Nothing. Quit living out a relationship based upon what you deserve. Yes. Amen. And start rejoicing in God that in his abundant grace and loving kindness, he's poured out upon us such mercy. Such mercy. According to his mercies, we are saved. Because of the abundance of his mercy, because of the abundance of his grace. Because of his great love wherewith he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses and sins. Yeah, I'm going to tell you. Because listen and understand, and I love that when you do that, because that's true. That's more in line with true worship. Then when we're singing songs, that doesn't have anything necessarily to do with true worship. People want to say it's true worship. True worship is that which comes forth from the heart. It's an inspiration busting up out of our belly in a response to the goodness of God and to the mercy of God and the loving kindness of God and the working of his mighty power. It's about time you and I demand a change, the change that God himself has given. It's about time you and I demand the response that God has reasonably placed before us. It's about time you recognize that you carry and bear the responsibility for a local church, and your behavior has huge consequences, and your attitudes and your demeanor has huge consequences. Huge for you, not for me, for you. It has huge consequences for the lost that come in here, for the religious that are bound in religion. For the people who are supposedly free but still are bound in some sort of sin. There are people that are watching me on the web right now, and possibly people in here today. You are still bound in sin. There is sin that still has hold on you. You're bound by the attitude of it. You're bound by the thought of it. You're even bound by the practice of it. And God has extended his mercy and an opportunity in his loving kindness and his long suffering for you to turn from it, for you to receive what the blood has supplied. And all you've got to do is get this thing right and recognize what he's going to be willing to do on your behalf for you. All of his paths are mercy. No matter what road you take with God, it's going to be mercy. As being his people, we know that all the days of our life, mercy and goodness shall follow us. Mercy and goodness will be right there serving us. Mercy and loving kindness will be right there serving us. God's goodness. And we shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. And we shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. And I shall dwell. I'm sealed by the Spirit of the Lord. And I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. I mean, think about it, people. This is just dress rehearsal for eternity. This is just an opportunity for men to make a decision. This is the time in which God is finding for himself a people who want to walk with him forever, who want to receive a so great a salvation, who are willing to be his people. And you decided to be? Why don't you go all the way? Yeah. Why don't you go all the way with God? Yeah. Hallelujah. And get caught up in what Jesus has done for you. Yeah. Rather than what you've done for him. And then you'll start doing a lot more. Yeah. And you're caught up in what he's done for you. And then you're never going to take glory to yourself when it's no longer about you. Yeah. It's no longer about your spiritual report card. Yeah. You don't worship God because you've done well. Are you don't refrain from worshiping God because you've done bad, because then your worship is based upon you and not upon him. Yeah. And all these things sorted out. Whereas God's sorting it out. He desires truth in the inward parts. He's going to make us to know where we have wrong and bad behavior. God is good. It's about time we start waking up and listening to what the Holy Spirit, the teacher, has come to say to show us how to walk this holy way. Yes. Hallelujah. If it were not for the Lord's mercies, if it is of the Lord's mercies that we are not consumed, because his compassions fail not. These are two different mercy words. They are new every morning. There is an unlimited supply from an everlasting God who has all power and all authority, who makes the rules and decides how it's going to be. An unlimited provision of his divine and infinite everlasting resources of his own person, bound in this love that he displays for us, giving us what we do not deserve and giving it to us abundantly, as though we had done everything that was perfect before him and right before him. For he sees us and has brought us miraculously into the life of Jesus, his only begotten Son. This is amazing. This is amazing.
This is amazing.
Tonight, I'm going to minister on the shield of faith. I believe the Lord's going to allow me to do that. And people need to hear it. Because you're allowing all kinds of stuff to make a mockery out of you. You're allowing all kinds of things to influence you that have nothing to do with God, nothing to do with what Jesus did or what Jesus is doing, has nothing to do with what the Holy Ghost has done and is doing. Has nothing to do with a single word of truth, and you're allowing behaviors, and you're allowing attitudes and dispositions and decisions to be produced in your life by it, and it's nothing other than demonic powers that the scripture refers to as fiery darts from the wicked one. It's demonic influence. It's oppressive demon spirits that will stop the flow of the Spirit of the Lord in your life. And it's just time for you to make some decisions about what kind of life you're going to live. And that you understand that the fundamental rule and law of that life that God has for you to live is that it's no longer about you. It's about what Jesus has done for you. It's no longer about your performance, about what he has done and what he's doing. It's about having all that you have from him brought to you by way of Jesus. And it's the act of his mercy. And it's the abundance of mercy and of his grace, an unlimited mercy and an unlimited grace of God's divine empowerment and God doing for us what we do not deserve. And the moment you think you deserve it, something's gone wrong with you. Something's gone wrong with you. I hate the phrase and despise it. Oh, you deserve it. I despise the phrase.
Oh, you deserve it. Jeremiah described what we deserved. Many other prophets described what we deserved. What we deserve, and every one of us are guilty of it. And God in his righteous judgment could execute it. We are deserving of an eternity without him, a place called hell, the lake of fire. For Father could at any moment and any time account my sin. He could call me into question if he wanted to for the sin that I committed in my life. Could call you into account for the sin. But in his goodness, by his mercy, by through the blood, he has erased them and removed them, and they no longer exist. An excellent time for you to shout. But wait. Until it's real to you, there won't be much of a shout. You'll have more for your team than for him. You have more for what you know in an earthly realm than in response to this declaration. But if you'll take a hold of that which God has brought to us through his glorious salvation through the blood of Jesus, oh, I'm telling you right now, you'll make a connection with a Holy Ghost shout. You'll make a connection with what it truly means to be thankful. Because men have been so twisted and so tweaked, they don't even know how to truly be thankful. They're so convoluted and so conflicted with all the things in this world around them. And they've yielded their members to all kinds of influences that are other than that which is true and real and eternal. Oh, let God touch you today. Let him. Because he proclaims all these things and he says all these things to work a miracle for you to be different. You just got to understand, people, if you've given yourself to wrong behavior for a long time. I love it. I love the way that they say about the golf swing. If you've got a wrong golf swing, you've practiced a wrong golf swing, it takes something ridiculous. It's over 1,500 correct swings to break the influence of the wrong one. Huh? People practicing the wrong swing in God. Amen. Well, Father's going to intervene. He's going to work a miracle for those who go get desperate and say, Lord, because you know what? It takes discipline that most people don't have to go ahead and practice something right one move 1,500 times. I mean, I would love to see people aspiring to excellence in God. Such is not the case. Look at the lawn. And I can go on and on. But what we could do is we can begin to cry out to God in his mercy and his loving kindness, relying upon his grace, and say, Father, I recognize that the things that I've been doing aren't the way that you purposed them to go on in my life. I've been doing it wrong. And Lord, there's no way that of my own self I can ever get it right. So God, I ask you to come and intervene and work this miracle for me. And I promise you, he will. And it, you know, it may be like a sickness or it may be like a disease and it doesn't seem like the cure is coming right when you want it. I mean, I can give you an example. You know, Mary and Martha sent for Jesus and they wanted the cure right away. Our brother's sick, come. Jesus didn't come.
Yeah.
You know, Mary, who sat at Jesus' feet and was all affectionate towards him, she's the first. Now, all of a sudden, she's at home, doesn't even see Jesus. Martha, who was busy taking care of feeding everybody and taking care of other things, it wasn't so much the portrait of a disciple. She runs out to him and says, I know even now that if you say the word, he can live. Look at Mary sitting home. She's all offended, upset because Jesus didn't come. He didn't really even care. Something happened. Something's going on. I mean, look, we're all a bunch of act-alikes. We're look-alikes, too. So I said, no, I'm just praying. Jesus had got something bigger planned. He's got bigger plans. Just because it looks like it's taking a little while, it's bigger. Just, you just keep asking. You keep confident. You be confident. You boldly run out to meet him.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I'm going to tell you right now, you look at what Jesus did. He stopped and he said, I'm not going any further. He did. Yep. Till Mary comes. Get Mary here. And if Mary would have stayed home, it would have been no miracle. No. Martha says, Mary, he's calling you. First thing she comes, she reveals her heart. No. Why did you come? My brother wouldn't have died if you'd have come. Well, you got confidence in the healing, but I'm going to give you some confidence in something bigger than that.
People just understand, listen, if things are going on in your life that aren't the proper behavior, say, Lord, I don't want this in my life. I want to understand. I want to understand that and flow and function with you. Thank you, Father, for the word of knowledge. Thank you, Father, for the word of wisdom. Thank you, Father, for the discerning spirit. Thank you, Father, for the working word. Thank you, Father, that I'm going to be a part of your glorious church. I'm not going to stand around and talk about how the Baptists aren't a part of your glorious church when I'm not being a part of your glorious church. Because what is your definition of a glorious church? Just because you can quote a few verses of scripture and put them together accurately? Give me a break. The glorious church is the manifestation of the Holy Ghost, living the life of Jesus. Every word of God is given so that you and I can display the power and life and glory of Jesus Christ. Every moving of the Holy Ghost is given for the purpose of you and I displaying the marvelous and glorious and wonderful life that God has brought to pass for us in this wonderful miracle called the new birth.
Yeah. Hebrews 7:25. I pray that every one of you that are here in this place watching me by the web, they just open up your Bible and just start looking at all the verses of Scripture on mercy. And just let it be highlighted to you that every time you see it, it's God doing something for somebody that they don't deserve. And that's for every one of us, and that's just the way it is, and that continues to be that way. And there with that mercy, he pours out abundance of grace, which is God's ability, God's empowerment, God giving to us a favor, once again, that we don't deserve, and an empowerment and an ability that without it, we could never do anything that would please him. I'm going to tell you today, God wants you to forget and abhor and be disgusted on the level that Paul was disgusted with all the things that you think you are and think you can do. And he used outhouse, he used potty words. To describe the best of his best. And the reason he should be favored, and the reason he should have a position with God, and the reason he should have extra special attention. Because he recognized that it got in the way of him being able to receive that which Father was supplying. He recognized that if he had anything to it, any affinity to it, that it would get in the way of him being able to receive all that Father freely gives in his mercy and his grace to those who put their whole trust in Christ Jesus alone and find all their righteousness in him. Hallelujah. There you're free to live in righteousness. There you're empowered to live out righteousness. There you're free to live in holiness. There you're empowered to live in holiness. Hallelujah. Sometimes I hear things and I just got to check, was it a human being or was it from heaven? Hallelujah. I love it when heaven shouts out, amen.
Amen.
You want to make Father happy?
Then
find all your confidence and trust in the blood of Jesus Christ to the point that it excites you, it impacts and affects every one of your emotions, every one of your behaviors, every one of your responses, it's the influence of every dimension of how you feel. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hebrews chapter 7 and verse 25. It's tough to step down into the midst of this right here at this moment in time because it's just surrounded by so many good things in God. But wherefore he is able, speaking of Christ Jesus, who is our high priest, who has an unchangeable priesthood, a priest not for himself, but a priest for you and me, who finds his whole purpose of living to continually pray for us. Intercede on our behalf, that we would be strengthened, that we would be able to do this, that we'd be able to step into the divine destiny that God placed in this church when he called this church into existence, when he began to describe things, those wonderful things that are available for us to step into if we would trust in the blood of Jesus Christ and rely upon the Holy Ghost. That it's high time that it begins to happen, that you begin to understand how to move with God. Understand how to walk in the Spirit and live by the Spirit. How to respond properly to what God has done for us. And only the Holy Spirit alone can give us that proper response. The Word of God shows us how. But the Holy Spirit makes it so real.
He is the life to the spirit and the soul, that the spirit and the soul is to the body. Understand it. Understand it. Without your spirit and soul, your body is dead. It doesn't exist. It's lifeless. It can't move. It sits there silent. It might be able to clap. No, can't even clap. It sits there silent. Has no expression. No matter what you say, there will be no expression. But the Spirit of the Holy Ghost brings to our spirit and soul such divine expression that our body gets to participate with. Hallelujah. 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 Just become. This day, let the rule of divine life rule you. That every expression should be rejoicing and thanksgiving. Every expression should be confidence in God. And anything less, let the Holy Spirit just infuse you and fill you afresh and be continually filled with the Spirit or continually baptized in the Holy Ghost so that you can bring that to the meeting so there's just not one or two people flowing in the Holy Ghost while everybody else sits there trying to figure out what to do. People, I'm not looking to, God's not looking, and I'm not, as a minister of the gospel, looking to see where your talents and where your giftings lie so that we can just boast in whatever your specialty is. Because if we look hard enough, we can find a good thing in the most rank sinner. We're not looking for that. We're not desiring that. We're not here to talk to you about your giftings and talents and where your strengths are. We're here to supply to you an opportunity to live out a divine life and to express the heavenly realm as the Church of Jesus Christ. And we want to help you. Those of you who don't understand that, we want to help you to understand that. Those who do understand it, if you're not allowing it to happen in your life, you need to find out what hinders. Because I can understand people who don't understand it, thus they don't know how to cooperate with it. But I don't understand people who supposedly understand it, but don't allow it to be displayed. There is no excuse for that. There is a problem there. And we want to break that yoke. And today, I'm going to tell you, you could break it. You don't have to have 1,500 swings right. You don't have to, look here, you don't have to live 1,500 days right to get it. It's about faith. Without faith, it's impossible to please God. Those who live after human ability, it's impossible to please God. He has a supply, and he has the answer for you right now. Because here's what the Lord will do for everybody who put their trust in him. Wherefore, he is able to save them to the uttermost. Utterly. I don't care who you are, where you come from, what's going on. I don't care if you're just so analytically brain or analytically spirit dead that you have no expression hardly of the movings of God. He is able to save you utterly, completely, absolutely from whatever it is that hinders you. Jesus said, those who love much, those who are forgiven much, love much. The reality of it is, Simon and all the rest of the Pharisees in the house had just as much to be forgiven for. They just couldn't see it. They had a warped perspective of reality. It was solely based on who they thought themselves to be and what they thought God wanted. Thus, they completely disqualified God's revelation to them. The woman, she had nothing. The rich of this world are hardest to come into the kingdom. Those who are rich materially or those who are rich in other different ways that our society will enrich in people. I mean, you can have poor scientists at UCSD who drive a 1967 Chevrolet, that they are rich in what men would give to them. Thus, they are so arrogant and proud, and their perspective of life is so warped. They can't hear nothing. They think they know it all. They think they have the answers. And they have the answers to nothing that is about reality in life. They have no answers for eternity. They have no answers for the soul.
And what's more important, that you understand photosynthesis? Or that you understand eternal life? That you understand some enzyme in the gut of a frog? Or that you understand the movings of the Holy Spirit? And I'm just taking the gut of the frog and photosynthesis and trying to make it a high watermark.
Yeah.
At least to categorize the rest of it. If they would have just received the revelation of Jesus, they would have been down there with the woman. The woman had nothing. She had nothing to boast in herself in. She had nothing. And she saw the answer to everything she had need of.
Amen.
She was loving much. She loved much because she was forgiving much. Today, I pray that you could be joining the ranks of those who are forgiven much.
Yes. 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 Amen.
Jesus. Hallelujah.
I I pray that today you will join the ranks of those who are worthless without Him. Some people, it's very hard for you to be worthless because your society has made you something. You got rewarded. You got a trophy for being last. You got a trophy for failing. And worse than that, you got a trophy for succeeding. Look at the group of people you were running with. Huh? A blind man. Look, a one-eyed man is a legend among the blind. Think about it. The value systems of men are warped. And if you find your approval and your value there, it's false. False value. Say the Lord is good.
The Lord is good.
And His mercies endure forever.
His mercies endure forever.
Thank you, Lord.
In the name of Jesus, there's not one single person going to walk out of this place with a cough or with some kind of a throat thing. I haven't had this going on in my body at all. I get in here this morning and can't even hardly talk. It's ridiculous. In the name of Jesus, you old foul spirit of virus and sore throat and cough and infection, you go out in the name of Jesus. You have no right. Hallelujah. But you notice I'm up here feeling real bad about myself because, you know, I'm going to cough and I shouldn't have one because, after all, you know, the Lord has given us the ability to be uninfected by disease. Listen, if I make my worth and the value of who I am and how Father feels about me based upon anything other than what He purchased for me when He poured out His blood at Calvary, He spared not His own Son. Listen what the all-powerful, the one who's all-sufficient, the one who possesses everything, all the resources are His. Listen to what He says. He spared not His own Son, but offered Him up for the sins of us all. How shall He not also by Him freely give us all things? He has all the wealth, all the wealth, all the riches, all the resources. They all belong to Him. He's the absolute sovereign. There is no power that exists that's greater than His power. He decides the things, and that's the way it's going to be.
Yeah, come on, thank you, Father.
There is no sickness. There is no disease. There is nothing that is out of place that He does not have all ability to instantaneously fix it.
And when He tells us that He will save us to the uttermost, it's not just about bringing us all the way to the place where we stand before Him and He says, "Well done, my good and faithful servant." It's about Him also supplying to us everything that the blood of Jesus purchased for us. It's about Him supplying to us right now everything that belongs to the realms of the Holy Ghost, so that the yokes of demonic oppression and sin and iniquity can be broken off of a sin-cursed world. So that the chains of darkness and oppression, the mind-blinding spirits that hide the gospel, will no longer be able to influence and affect those people that are around us. And Father's looking for a people to do it through. Everybody, would you stand with me? Stand with me. Today, there are people in here, you've been allowing unholy things in your life. Today, you need to reach out and grab a hold of the mercy and the grace of God that breaks off that yoke. And recognize this, that those things are still going to come at you. Those things are still going to tempt you. Because Satan is allowed up to a certain point to see if you want to be on his side. And one of the things that he uses now against God's people, probably more than anything else, strife and envy and sexual immorality of all sorts. And because our society has opened up the door to all kinds of rebellion and the liberal progressive agenda that makes iniquity okay, has opened the door. If our society opened the door to murder, there would be all kinds of murdering going on. You understand me? There'd be a spirit of murder on more people they couldn't even imagine. People who wouldn't even think about murder would be thinking about murder. It's true, because it's a spiritual realm. When our society opened up the doors to homosexuality, people who had never even thought about such a thing suddenly begin to be influenced by it because it's a demonic spirit. And people want to just make it about something that belongs to a realm that God doesn't even exist in. I'm going to tell you right now, God feels everything. There's no realm in which God doesn't exist. It's all created by Him and for Him. He's the everlasting God. Before there was a mountain formed, before the heaven and the earth was in existence, God existed. All things were created by Him. And without Him was not anything made. People are constantly opening up the doors to all kinds of iniquity. Praise God for His mercy. So if you're being harassed and tormented by something evil, the precious blood of Jesus Christ washes you and cleanses you by you grabbing a hold of it and saying, "Father, I don't want to be this. I don't want to do this. I don't want to yield my members to a realm of iniquity." And then in His mercy and His grace, He's there helping you and teaching you how to have a resolve to say no. Choose the right way. All His paths are mercy. Amen. You walk down these other paths, I'm going to tell you right now, there's going to be no mercy for you. Satan wants to destroy you. The God of this world set Himself to destroy you. The rise, you know, the Lord's just really been making me aware of it even more, but the rise of human cooperation with the demonic is becoming more blatant than ever before. I mean, Satan has always been the god of this world, and he's always mustered a lot of people to function and operate with him. But sometimes it's been almost like men doing it on an unconscious level, so to speak. But when all of a sudden you've got agendas going on in our nation as they're going on by what we call the liberal progressive, the immoral party,
that immorality somehow is a virtue. And that the new morality is immorality. And then you begin to measure the rise of the iniquity where people are saying, we are Satanists, we're witches, and we're this and that, and all these kinds of crazy things. And then you look at the measure and the number of it just in San Diego alone, of how many people are involved in Satan worship. And I recently have been made aware of it just because of this thing that they plan to do here today in San Diego. All over the nation, but in San Diego, which is foremost where the battle is raging for us as a church. Because we got to fight on several fronts. We got to fight on the religious front, because people are all upset because we allow everybody to pray in tongues all at the same time. Well, if you don't like praying in tongues all at the same time, you shouldn't pray any kind of prayer all at the same time. People are upset because everybody's singing in tongues at the same time. Well, if you're upset about everybody singing in tongues at the same time, you should be upset about everybody singing in any way all the time. Because it makes no sense. So we're having to deal with a religious front. We're having to deal with a worldly front. We're having to deal with the front of people who are not decided. They're coming into the building and they want to participate on the highest level of worship and praise and stand on the, as it were, feel like they need to be in front of everybody, and they've not decided to worship God and serve God alone. Nonsense. Nobody's allowed up on this platform unless you're sold out to Jesus. I'm not saying that you don't make mistakes and don't, have issues. Say you're sold out. I'm not allowed up here. Not allowed. You decide you're going to walk with God, and that's it. You're not allowed up here. You're allowed to be out there. And I wish, my heart's desire is that everybody would move to the platform. And that we just turn all of you guys into a big, gigantic choir, and then you fill the seats with people who suddenly have seen the light of the God's divine grace and glory shining through us. Where you think, how else is the world going to see? The level of people who are ardently committed to saying that the deception of Christianity will no longer influence our society, that this is the age of the satanic, of giving this world over to the God that it belongs to. And they pray to demons to protect us from the good. But they don't make it. They change the good and make it evil. It's the same way in mythology and mysticism. Everything that they're saying, praying to their gods for against evil, actually the evil is God. The evil is the one who destroyed the world with a flood. That's the evil God, the God we serve. In Greek mythology and, Syrian mythology and all the ancient myths, that's what that's all about. And now that culture is arising again. It's right here in the city. God's got to have some people who are going to just dive into the blood. Dive into the realms of the Spirit. Say, we walk with God. We are the Lord's. We are the people of God. We are the people of God. And He is our Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. For He is able to save them to the uttermost that come unto God by Him. I will never come to the Father. Ever, but by Jesus. I will never have a relationship with the Father apart from Jesus Christ. Not one second. Not one second. And for you to be able to do that, your life has got to be worthless to you. It's got to be meaningless to you. And all that you can accomplish and all that you can do has to have no value. Otherwise, you won't like that. You mean I just can't come to God based on myself? No. We exist in Christ Jesus, in Him alone. And today I want God's Holy Spirit to grab a hold of you and cause you to recognize His mercy, and cause you to recognize His grace, cause you to recognize His goodness.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Thank you, living God. Therefore, there is now no condemnation to those who exist and live in Christ Jesus. If you have condemnation, it's one of two reasons. Either you do not exist in Christ Jesus, or you've allowed harassing, tormenting demon spirits to influence your thoughts and your behavior and your thinking. And today, in the name of Jesus Christ, no matter which one it is, let it come to an end.
Yes. Yes.
To deal with the first issue, all you must do is call upon the name of the Lord and you will be saved. The Lord makes it so simple and it's so easy. And God, the fire of God will fall upon you with the revelation of the Holy Ghost, which brings such truth, which brings such clarity, that if there is any falsehood, it will be exposed, like it was with Simon when Peter and John came down to Samaria to bring the baptism of the Holy Ghost after Philip had preached. Oh, I love the fire of God. Ha. The fire of God isn't for purity, for cleansing. The blood of Jesus does that. Fire of God is for clarity, truth, and insight. And all you gotta do is let the fire of God burn on you right now. And you won't be held back anymore. You won't be living in any kind of influence of wrong. Let the blood of Jesus Christ cleanse you right now, right this moment. Let the blood of Jesus Christ cleanse you right now to where that you find now your whole existence in Him. Let the blood of Jesus Christ cleanse you on a level to where that you find your existence in Him. Not just cleanse you on a religious level, but cleanse you on a level to where that now you live in Him and you find your life in Him and your worth in Him. God will work this miracle for you right now. I don't care if you're standing in here or if you're listening to me by the web. God will work this miracle for you right now. He responds to the cry of the heart. He responds to the needy heart that says, oh God, I want you. I want to live for you. I want to be yours. And then without hesitation, instantaneously, He makes it happen. Here, give me Him. I'm not infectious, I just sound like it.
The Lord says, my love is not hard. My love is not hard. My love is good. My love is easy. My love is freedom. My love is omnipotent. My love is sovereign. My love is blessing. Many people have treated God like their dad has treated them, where if you do your chores or you do good, and sometimes you get your allowance or submission and obedience is optional. That cannot have any place. That is, God does not treat you like that. I feel so strongly the Lord saying, my people need to believe me for the best. They need to believe me for the best things, for the best gifts, for the best things, huh? They need to believe me for bigger. They need to believe me for greater. What's the point in asking if you're not going to go all out in believing for the very best from God? There must be the fire of the faith. It must be so impossible that there's no way it can happen by any other way than by God. So believe God for the best. Believe God for greater. Believe God for bigger. Because His love for you is good. His love for you is not hard. Hallelujah.
You don't have to work for this. You don't have to earn this. All you have to do is receive. And in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, those who have seemed to have a hard time receiving, that hard time ceases to exist. That those rivers and that flow which God has promised that would sweep you away in your emotions and your passions would be realized by you today. That you won't find your value in something less than what Christ Jesus has done. And that you won't settle out for anything less than all that God the Holy Spirit supplies. You won't say, oh, well, I'm doing this one thing and I can do that. I might not be able to do anything else, but I can do this one thing. And so, you know, I'm just going to be happy and content to do that. No. That's not the right way. That's not God's way. That's not what the Holy Spirit teaches. That's not what the Word of God calls us to be and to do. This day, believe God that all those things which He freely supplies, all those things which Christ Jesus intercedes for us to have, that they'll be realized in you today. That it won't be bent over, bowed down with a sense of sorrow and despair. But it'll be standing upright with your face shining bright with a confidence that all that God supplied is yours now. A boldness, having been resourced. If the wealthiest man in the world comes to you and says, go and do whatever you think is good, I'll back you up. Whatever you want to purchase, I'll make it good. Whatever you want to do, I'll support it. And you had a pledge and a guarantee of it. My, suddenly you'd be able to dream big. Suddenly you'd be able to occupy yourself. And you know, and if you were wise, you'd begin to start doing research to make sure that you knew how to make better decisions than the ones you've been making over your, you know, tens of thousands or hundreds of thousands or whatever just to monetize it. The Father has done that and He's done far more. It's just all of that. There has to come a transition in our life where we let God be who He is. I mean, it's almost like saying we've got to empower God. Because we've limited Him. He's all powerful. He has He is unlimited power. That's who He is. It's not like He's got unlimited power and He's not doing anything. In the name of Jesus Christ today, by the power and the authority the Spirit of the Lord and the blood of Jesus, I beg you, I plead with you, grab a hold of divine provision and start speaking it out and start living it out. Some people want to live it out, they don't want to speak it out. It ain't going to happen. That's not God's rules. He makes the rules. God said you speak it out and you can live it out. Hallelujah. That's what He says. You speak it out and you can live it out. Somebody said, oh, are you saying it's name and claim it? I say it's better than that. It's far more powerful than that. I want you to pray with me as I begin to lead you in prayer that this church will be the church, the kind of church that Father purchased, that Christ Jesus purchased with His own blood. That the Holy Spirit was poured out for us to be, and we'll quit being anything less. And everybody here today is in agreement with me. I pray that you'll begin as we pray to recognize that somehow This isn't an event that might happen. Or somehow you might be able to touch God and he hear your request. But you'll recognize that this is what Father is pleading and begging you to participate with, and you'll just receive it. Father, I come to you right now. We come to you as a church. We ask, and I want you to pray. I don't want you to say, yes, Lord. Father, we come to you as a church, and we ask you right now in the name of Jesus Christ, let every part of that which you supplied to the church begin to be realized by us right now. Hold up. Stop. I don't hear anybody praying but myself. I would turn off my mic, but people want to hear me. And I want you to lift up your voice. I want you to begin to pray with me. And I'm going to be leading in prayer, but you just go ahead and pray along the same theme. You don't have to be listening to what I'm saying necessarily. Sometimes people can listen and talk at the same time. But I want you to pray, and I want you to begin. But I'm going to ask you one more time. I'm going to say this one more time. Can everybody hear me? I want you to lift up your voice and pray. And I don't want you to pray like a Baptist or a Nazarene. The Nazarene used to know how to pray. They don't know how to pray anymore. They used to be called the Noisarenes when they wanted a Pentecost. And they lost all that. And I almost say the same thing for the Assemblies of God. But I don't want you to, and I'm making a point. I'm not trying to bring shame to anyone. I'm just making a point. I don't want you to be under the influence of denominationalism. I want you to get real with God. And I want you to begin to ask him to show you how to move with him so that you can function as a member in the body of Christ and participate with the church. Because the body of, you cannot function as a member of the body of Christ without the manifestation of the Spirit. And that's the way that Paul described it, and that's the way it is. And I want you to begin to cry out to God with me today. That which he purchased with his own blood would begin to shine bright in the midst of this place. Not because you're believing I'm going to do it, but because you're believing you're going to now start participating with God. You're going to take the responsibility for the local church. And so I want you to pray. I don't want another this little small, you know, sound of prayer, a little crybaby prayer. I want some prayer of authority in this place. Because some of you have been standing around here way too long to have anything less than a fiery prayer. Now step up. Get right with God. Quit giving your best to something else. This isn't about, and even if you were normally mealy-mouthed and had no real strength or authority, it doesn't even matter now and then the Holy Ghost. Because God, the Holy Ghost, comes and brings us a power, a flow, and a divine authority. It's not even human. It's not even human. It's divine. So I want you to lift up your voice. I want to be able to hear you pray. I don't wonder, are they praying up there? Because no sense in pretending or asking God to help us understand, to cause us to understand how to participate with his glorious church. And it's like, oh, Lord, what is all about? Where's the truth in that? There's no reality in that. And the only way that you're ever going to have an earnestness, and the only way that you're going to have that cry, that seriousness, that depth, is to begin right now. The Holy Ghost is going to come down and give you, just start opening your mouth and moving your jaws up and down. You know what I mean? Hallelujah. So I want you to begin to pray right now. Father, we ask you right now in the name of Jesus that those, oh Lord, who have lingered so long will linger no more. That your glorious church will begin to be revealed in the midst of this church, in the midst of every church, oh God, who will believe you, who will walk with you, who will lay hold on divine authority, that it will happen now, that the flow of the Holy Spirit and the working of the Holy Ghost
will be made manifest and be revealed in among us, oh God. The people won't be just diddle-dallying around anymore, oh God, but everybody begin to get serious with you and lay hold upon you and take the responsibility of walking in your divine power and your divine authority. In the name of Jesus. Yes, Lord. Father, you alone can do this. You alone have all power. You alone bring these things to pass. Father, we desire to do what you will. We desire to do it your way as you've revealed it in your word. Hallelujah. Now, that, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Yes. Yes. Yeah. Ha ha. Let me say this. Yeah. Hallelujah. Yeah. Let me say this. That's awesome. Yeah. Let me say this. Let me say this now, because that's prayer. Some of you, I can feel some of you touching heaven. I pray in the name of Jesus that you bring that cry and you bring that display of passion, of hunger and thirst when you walk into the meeting, the first part of the meeting. I want to see God's people. I'm tell you right now, I want to see God's people touching heaven like Sandy and Paul is touching heaven right now. Instead of just doing whatever it is that you normally do, I want to see you begin to function and display the power of God that drives you to your knees. That touches every part of your passions and your emotions. So that you can begin to walk over in the realms of divine power and glory and bring a praise and bring a song that will take you to the same place. Quit being you. Loaded down with all of your issues and all of your problems. Start being him and you won't have any more. You won't have any more problems and issues. Start living your life in Christ Jesus from this day forward. I am calling God's people to do this. Don't make any mistake. I'm talking to you. It's time for you to start living your life in Christ Jesus instead of living your life in you. And that is not something that you've got to wonder what that looks like, because you can see the display of the person of Jesus Christ on every page in the Bible. Behold, the volume of the book is written of him, and you are going to decide whether or not you're going to do this or continue to live you, your life, your expressions. And I believe better things of you. You listen to me. I don't care who says that they're a leader in this church. If they don't act like me, they're not a leader in this church. I don't care who they say they are or who you want to make them. And I'm saying this over the web for every church and any church. You are not a leader in Christ Jesus' church unless you're walking in the things of his life and of his spirit. And you are an example every day of what it means to reveal the glory of heaven. So quit having a false pretense and doing things that are just completely irrelevant to that which God is passionate about displaying. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And if you'll recognize it and you won't have an ear to listen to the lies of hell and receive a defeated attitude, huh? In a self-promotion or a self-demotion attitude, then you'll lay hold
on what Father has provided, and you'll quit being influenced by the spirit of this world. Because the spirit of this world has many different influences. It can be from the ultimate evil and debauchery that we hear about in our society, or it can be to the subversion of the expression of the divine power of His glory. To subvert the display of heaven's glory. And it's about time you get yourself some discernment. I don't care how old you are. I don't care how much Bible you know. If you do not know how to live this life, it's time that you learn, because it's the only real relevant display of truth. And everything that the Word of God is doing, and everything that the Spirit of the living God is doing, is at work to bring this display in our lives, and we've got to yield to Him and cooperate with Him. And that's what it's all about. That's what it's all about. So people can tell you all kinds of things. If I came up here and I told you all mysteries and told you all knowledge and were able to describe to you the beginning from the end, and I could not display this glory and this manifest presence of Jesus, it's nothing. It's nothing. It's meaningless. Because real revelation will have an outworking of demonstration. This is what God says. And today, if these things are going in your life, you repent. You repent of misbehaving. You repent of wrong attitudes. You ask the Lord, shine the floodlight upon my soul and let me see things that I've allowed. Because one spiritual violation in your lifetime isn't a big deal. It's the behavioral patterns that the spiritual violation established in your life. So it isn't something about yesterday. It's something about right now. It's something about how you can hear the Word of God presented over and over and over and over again, but yet you are unwilling to alter your behavior. Where you can hear the Word of God presented over and over again, but yet you still act like you. You have to deal with that. I can't deal with that. You've got to get real with God. And if you get real with Him, listen, once again, His mercy supplies to everyone who's willing. And in Lot's case, boy, does that ever describe mercy. Because they didn't even look very willing. It was based upon someone interceding. And I think about Jesus interceding for me right now. Like Abraham was interceding for Lot. If Abraham's prayer and intercession be effective for Lot or God's angels, God Himself will come grab their hands, grab the hands of Lot, grab the hands of Lot's wife, grab the hands of Lot's daughters. I mean, emphasizes it like that. To drag them out in His mercy to preserve their life. How much more? What's going on right now? So people, really, you think about all of this. We almost have to actually be opposing God not to have what He's described. I mean, we've really almost got to be opposing God. Are you with me? When you put it in the context of Genesis chapter 19 and recognize Hebrews 7:25, we've almost got to be opposing God, resisting God, not to have all that He has supplied. So I want you just to grab a hold of that passion of the Holy Ghost. You begin to bring that. You begin to bring the cry of the heart. The cry of the heart. Which is the cry of the heart of boldness and confidence. But it is a cry. It is something. If it's not deep in your emotions, then you listen to me. You start praying until it gets deep in your emotions. Because God's not interested in what's coming out your throat. Get it deep. Let these things become deep. Yes. To where boldness results, confidence. And you're not walking around, you know, constantly ducking. And then somebody, you know, just goes to comb their hair and you're ducking. Like you're going to get hit. You know what? Jesus' name. Jesus' name. Because the Lord's standing saying, I'm not moving till you come here. I tell Mary to come. I'm not moving. I'm staying right here. We're going to take it one step further till you come.
I've come this far. You've got to come the rest of the way. Get over here. You come out to greet me properly. Where's Mary? She's home sulking. Where's the one that before was sitting at my feet was the first one to greet me when I arrived? But she's upset because she didn't get it on time. Or whatever it is that's going on, the dynamics of your life. Or the dynamics of your relationships. Make sure your relationships are right. Husband, make sure that your relationship with your wife is right. Wives, make sure that your relationship with your husband is right according to as God described it in, for example, even in Ephesians chapter 5. The end of the chapter. Because if they're not, they're going to stop you. But God still intervened with his mercy. There was a preacher, a man of God, as he would preach, his wife would sit on the front row and make fun at him and mock him. She had mental disease. And reproach him out loud, slander him. God used the man in an amazing way. As I understand it, his wife ultimately got delivered. Talk about mercy. Talk about a display of grace in a man. But still, you know, get things right. But, you know, if it goes beyond, everybody has to cooperate. If it goes beyond what you're able to get right, you know, maybe the husband doesn't want to cooperate. There's nothing you can do. Just hand it over to the Lord. And be empowered with God. Don't walk around, you know, feeling, you know, like you're somehow shamed. Because you're mercied. You're not shamed. You're mercied. You're graced. Or vice versa, how it may be. But these relationships with Father, these relationships that we have with people around us are important, a relationship with Father. And he says so again and again. Hallelujah. Art, some powerful, strong prayer starting to flow out there. Let's bear the responsibility to be the church that God described.
Yes.
And that doesn't mean that you're just going to be praying for it. You're going to rise up and do it. And if you don't rise up and do it, your prayers were not prayers of faith. They were not prayers of faith. They were prayers of religious observance. That's it. God empowers as he steps out and says, I'm going to do what you told me. I'm going to be your church. I'm going to do what you said to do. I'm going to do tongues interpretation. Yes. I'm going to do prophecy. Yes. I'm going to do miracles. I'm going to do signs and wonders.
Yes. Yes. Thank you.
I'm going to flow in the Holy Ghost.
Yes. Hallelujah.
When the preacher says, now, you know, this is your time now. It's worship. And this is your time to begin to prophesy one by one, begin to flow in that anointing of tongues, interpretation, tongues. It isn't going to remain a hush over the house. You can do something that fits, you know. Because you're bold.
Yes.
And you're confident.
Yes.
And you're certain.
Yes.
And you're well resourced.
Yes.
Hallelujah. The anointing was not given for us to stand and look strange. That's okay for the first introduction. After a while, there's got to be a divine expression.
Amen.
Otherwise, we believe that you've got to be healed of something.
Amen.
You hear me?
Thank you, my God.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Now the anointing of the Holy Spirit to heal, to deliver, to make everything new is present right now. The Spirit of the Lord is here to fix everything that needs to be fixed.
Yes, Lord.
So you can run wide open.
Yes, thank you, Father.
In the things of the Spirit and display and develop. Now understand, these things will not be developed and they will not mature in your life until you begin to give yourself to functioning in them. But as you do, God will grow you, mature you, and develop you. And the sound of it becomes stronger and more glorious. Hallelujah.
Yes.
And I say this, that if you would just practice all day being happy for the rest of the day, you just practice being happy on the level that it has an accompanying smile. Then by tonight, there would be more excessive joy. But if you leave here and you yield your members to the frown, to the sorrow, to the despair, to the depression imposed by the God of this world, the spirit that now works in the children of disobedience, then once again, there is nothing that you bring that God has required when you come. You then don't come as His people. That's what the Lord says. But then imagine what would happen is if you consecrated yourself and were willing to be set apart under this realm that God has called you to where that every day you gave yourself to this joy and to excessive joy to being developed more and more into the display of God's goodness. Then, the offering that you would bring when you come. The display of His power and the display of His goodness that would be there. And so it is with every area in the display and demonstration of the Holy Spirit. Maybe when you first begin to blast the trumpet of prophecy, it sounds like an unskilled horn blower. But before long, you give yourself to this trumpet blast of heaven. What happens? Then it becomes that distinctive voice, that well-played voice of an expert, a well-developed musician. And then you find yourself continually living in this display where no matter where you're at, of praise and thanksgiving and the utterances of prophecy in worship, in adoration, and in declaration of who God is and what He's purposed to do. It's with you. It rests with you. You can either be a part of this church that God designed, this one of supernatural power in the heavenlies, or you can continue on with the model that religion has imposed. You must decide, but decide. Decide. No longer waver between two opinions. No longer be back and forth, but decide. And if you'll decide, you'll find the strength and divine ability. For Father has released it without measure. It is supplied to us right now by the working of the Holy Ghost, who is here to lead us and teach us to do these things. To do these things. Hear it now. For many have misunderstood and they have not heard properly. The Holy Ghost has come to lead us and teach us how to do these things that belong to heaven in terms of the relationship. People want to make it about doing and they want to make it about deeds. That's the overflow. That is the consequence. That is the result of the relationship. Now, the spirit of prophecy is here, and anyone can do it, but you have to learn, you have to exercise, yielding yourself to the Holy Ghost. Somebody said, where do I do that? Worshiping Him and praising Him, just giving thanks for who He is.
The only person you need to convince of who God is, is yourself. And the more you praise Him, the more you're going to be convinced. Hallelujah. Because the Holy Ghost is going to come convince you. Isn't that great? Because if we were left to convincing ourselves, it wouldn't be a very good convincer. But God, the Holy Ghost, is the convincer to you. Do you understand me? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He's going to do more for you, far more for you than you'll ever be able to do for Him. Oh, yeah, He is. And I feel some of you really getting this. And I pray in the name of Jesus, every one of you get this.
Yes.
Get this. Take hold of this.
Yes.
Amen. Well, do as the Lord has said to do. Prepare an offering. And understand that this offering that we're going to give, this monetary offering, is not as important as the spiritual offering. But they are hooked up to some degree. But I know a lot of people give the monetary offering, they never give the spiritual offering. The spiritual offering, the sacrifices of the Lord, are praise and thanksgiving and worship. Amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah. Find a bunch of people around you, hug them, tell them that you love them, bless them in Jesus' name. Come back ready to prophesy. Stay right in the realm of prophecy. Okay, go ahead. Go ahead.
Lily, will you come up here? I want to pray with you. The Lord has something special for you today. And we all want to be hooked up with this church. We're one body in this church. We're one body. We're one family that goes after each and every person in this church. And Lily, the Lord has not turned a deaf mute to your prayers. The Lord has called you chosen. That desire of your heart as a child to be sold out for Him is still so powerful, but there's been a fight against your life, and the Lord is breaking it now in Jesus' name. No longer will the weapons of hell be formed against you. They will not prosper. In Jesus' mighty name, we break every stronghold off your life now in Jesus' mighty name. In Jesus' mighty name, we call you for the kingdom of God. Father, we thank you right now, Lord, that Lily will do signs and wonders. Father, that she's called for the supernatural, that she's called to do these greater things. Father, the Greater Works Ministry is Lily Deskins now in Jesus' mighty name. Now, in Jesus' mighty name, receive all that He has for you. A Father's love you've never known, Lily, comes about you now in Jesus' mighty name. An unconditional love right now in Jesus' mighty name.
Just lift your hands towards heaven, Lily. Lift your hands towards heaven. Don't brace yourself against the Lord. Just lift your... In Jesus' name. Receive right now. Just receive. Just receive right now. Father, we thank you for breaking off every yoke. Every yoke broken right now in Jesus' name. Yes, Lord Jesus. Thank you. Thank you, Jesus. Yes, Lord Jesus. Yes, Lord Jesus. Thank you, mighty God. Father, we pray in the name of Jesus that not one family member would be lost. Father, we pray in the name of Jesus that every person standing in this place will take hold of that great salvation and supply of the Holy Ghost for every one of their loved ones. Father, I pray right now in the name of Jesus that every incurable thing will be cured, that every yoke will be broken, that every stronghold of disease in the name of Jesus will have to go and flee away. Now in Jesus' name, that everything that Satan has done to try to hinder and lie and prevent the display of all that you have provided for us will be able to work no more. You do not want to leave this place today without getting right with God. You do not want to leave this place. Somebody said, well, I've been in church all of my life and it really hasn't worked for me. I just really haven't fit in. I really haven't seen much there. Listen, the Word of God is the description of what Father has for you. It should be that all men that are in His church should testify to that too. But at the end of the analysis, what God has described in His Word is what He has available for you and the change that can come. So whether you're standing in this place right now or you're watching online, I want you to understand God loves you so much. He is calling you. He's pleading with you to get right. There is an eternity before you. You do not want to go into eternity without God. You do not want to delay a response to His love. I promise you by what God has said, and He cannot lie, that a miracle change and a miracle salvation will come in your life. Yeah, you can easily be wrongly influenced by religion and by people who do not behave like God has described for us to behave, but you don't have to do that. And neither do you need to let that wrong description hinder you from moving forward with God. Because you could be a person who not only receives the miracle of salvation, but you walk in it and display it to where that Father has a witness in the earth of what it means to be born again. Amen. And filled with the Holy Ghost. Do not delay. Do not delay. Christ Jesus is calling you. God has supplied His own life and blood so that you could be cleansed from your sin and not be judged for them. Be certain, if you do not come for the cleansing that only the blood of Jesus Christ can supply, you will be judged for your sin, and the wages of sin is death. God in His mercy has supplied the only cure, the blood of Jesus. The blood is a synonym, if you would, for mercy, and mercy is only defined by His blood. You decide today. God wants you to decide for Him. The decision is yours. He's decided for you. Just want to wait a few more minutes. I am so blessed when people are willing to move in the giftings of the Spirit and the Word of knowledge, because today you've seen displayed tongues, interpretation of tongues. You've seen displayed prophecy, the Word of knowledge. You've seen displayed the working of the miracles of God. They've been more on the level of spiritual. But I also trust that there's been physical miracles that have taken place in people's bodies while we're ministering. Be certain of this. God loves you with an everlasting love. He loves you. And there's nothing of all of his glory and riches that he's withheld from you. It's time to start receiving them. Amen.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Well, worship the Lord with your tithes, with your offerings. If anybody needs prayer for anything, we're here to pray with you and for you. You can come. The Spirit of the Lord will touch you. Just come. No matter what you have need of, just come. The Lord will touch you. Sick in your body, tormented in your spirit. Whatever you have need of, Father is here to touch you. He's here to love on you. Sutaraba baba ba sikiti yoroba bo shikitan dala la mosh. Shitata romanda da da kili stipa. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. What's up, baby? Healed. Healed. In Jesus' name. In the name of Jesus. That virus gets off of you right now in the name of Jesus. What's up? What's up? What's up? What's your name? Hmm?
George.
George? Why are you here? What do you want? Hmm? What do you want? What do you want the Lord to do? Where are you from? Hmm? George, where are you from?
El Cajon.
El Cajon? You go to school there? So what do you want the Lord to do for you? You want to change your heart? Do you love your family?
Yes.
How many brothers do you have? Sisters?